And start. Hello, 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 guys, and welcome to Toon Kind D&D. We are going to be playing a game today called Give 'em the Bird, and I am your host, DM Gently Mad, and as you can tell, I am heckin' nervous. But if my lovely players will introduce themselves as we go down the line.
I guess it misses me first. Hi, I'm RJ. I'm playing... Do you want me to introduce who I'm playing, or...?
Yeah, you can mention who you're playing, yeah.
Alright. I'm playing Grills, the Fire Genasi, who has randomly become part Toon. No idea what he's in for.
Me and him both. Next. Alright, and Kai, go ahead.
I think Kraken's are... Oh, wait, no, shit, yeah, no. Oh. Why was I thinking I was at the bottom of the
list? Icy Soupy, baby!
Icy Soupy Knight.
Hi, I'm Kai. I don't know how to fucking read. And I'm going to be playing Charlie Black, the bard slash little bit of rogue slash con artist, who also, coincidentally, is real bad at reading, so I'm just getting in character here.
There you go.
Is Grills here the only one who knows how to read?
Possibly.
Maybe.
Possibly.
But, hi, it's me, Kraken. I'm playing Admiral Abigail, who, for the record, can read, but doesn't tend to.
Abigail can read, just chooses not to.
That's all for right. Nerds.
Yeah, nerds for nerds, jeez. Okay, and I, of course, am EM, and I am also going to be playing Regan... I forgot his name.
It'd be like that.
What's your name again? What's your name again? Ranger Sansford, Yuppian Toon Kind Ranger, who has currently called you guys out here to the middle of beautiful Floristralia, and we are we have sent you guys a message saying basically that there's been some trouble down here in the little community of Miami Beach. It is so called because it has one beach tree, and it's a retirement community. So, you guys are going to be meeting up at the... God, I'm shaking, y'all. I'm so scared.
I love you, Jendy.
Yeah, I can do it. So, you guys, we are meeting currently at the... hang on, let me pull up my notes here. We are currently meeting at the Croc in the Hole Pub at Miami Beach. That's where everybody's met. Basically, you guys, they sent out a thing sent out saying, hey, we need some help with some pests that are down here in this community. So you guys have come down here to investigate or been dragged forcibly down or something or trying to escape something else. I don't know. That's up to you guys.
Oh, I have something in mind.
So anyway, for some obscure reason, you guys have all ended up here at Miami Beach in the Croc and Hole Pub, and you are currently looking for Ranger Sansford. So basically, if you want to go ahead and just, you know, I guess look around or...
I do just want to say first up, gently, as an Aussie, I am loving every single one of these names. They are perfect.
I've been quietly wheezing into my dress.
Thank you.
Like, so, legitimately, I've driven through tiny little towns in the fucking outback with like these exact names. Just, like, these are great.
I've captured the nuance, the aesthetic, if you will. Okay, so you guys are in the pub right now, and if you have already noticed, you can see that the pub is consisting of a lot of what looks like retirees in various
bikinis and stuff, and they don't look too happy. There's also a bunch of farmers. The farmers and the retirees are kind of like, you know, keeping to themselves. You can tell that there's a little bit of tension going on here, and the bartender is up there, of course, you know, giving out the drinks and stuff. So if any of you guys want to talk to the bartender, you can.
Well, my first thought is Abigail getting on in age might look like she belongs with the retirees.
Oh no.
Yeah, the farmers are giving Abigail, all the farmers, whenever the group came in, the farmers kind of are like squinting at Abigail, you know, a little bit suspiciously, and the retirees are just looking disgruntled with the whole thing because their pub has been invaded by farmers, and now, oh great, there's a group of people coming in too as well. Looks like strangers, so you know, no, it's not really a friendly atmosphere right now, but you know.
That's great. Anyway, the bartender
just looks up, he gives Abigail a little bit of a double take, and then he's like, well, all right, come in, have a seat, sit down, I guess. You here for something? You here for somebody? I don't know.
If no one else is gonna take the not exactly take leave, but I know that Charlie is going to be in one of his many various not quite disguises, but also he's not going as himself. He is currently a calico cat going by the name of Lee White, and he is gonna go right up to the bar and go like, give me one of your best, mate.
All right. Yeah, okay, you know, he just kind of like looks at you, he turns around, you know, drops beer down there, you know, it's he's like, we got beer and light beer.
I'm going to meet him, pipes up, I'll take the white beer.
Okay, here you go. he takes a beer from it, pours it from the same tap, and basically like sets it on fire and just shoves it over there. He goes, there you are, light beer.
Excellent.
Yes, exactly. So what brings you out here and out in the middle of Miami Beach? You don't really look like farmers, and you don't really look like retirees either.
Kid Grills dressed in a suit sitting in this bar really awkwardly, like, yeah.
Yeah, pretty much.
Abigail looks faintly insulted at the idea of being referred to as a retiree.
Charlie is in full-on, full-on, kind of looking for trouble mode. It does not help that he's been hanging around the engineer and all that cowboy stuff a lot lately.
Oh god.
I reckon he's got just like a gold coin out and is just rolling it over his fingers and then taps against the bar and just like, heard you folks are having a spot of trouble. That sounds like a bit of fun to me. What's been going on?
Well, the barkeep just like shrugs and looks around. He looks at the retirees, then looks at, oh wait, hang on a second. Escape kitten, hang on a second. Barkeep says, oh dang, there's my escape kitten. I'll be right back.
Now we've got two cats on the loose.
Yeah, the kitten, excellent. It has escaped its cage. Yes. Yes! Kitten is out.
I'm going to turn off the heater one moment. I'll be right back.
Okay, I'm back. Sorry about that. Anyway, so the barkeep says, he looks at him and he says, you're with that Sansford's guy, aren't you?
Yeah, the name's ringing a bell.
Yeah, well, you know, he's kind of famous around here, this area. You know, he's supposed to be like a big game hunter and stuff, and he said he was going to be taking care of the problem around here. But yeah, and the barkeeper kind of like sighs, and he looks over at the retirees, looks at the farmers, and he looks over at Charlie and says, let me tell you something, friend, it's not been friendly here. See, this place right here, Miami Beach, we have it for like a group of retirees and stuff like that. So all the time, pretty much all you see is old people around here. And he kind of looks over at Abigail and he says, no offense.
Sniff as she takes a swig of drink.
he says, yeah, and there, so, but right now the farmers apparently have been coming in and by the droves because there's some kind of mess going on. I don't know. Sanford said something about birds or something. And again, he looks over at Abigail and then looks back at
Abigail. So. Yeah. You want more trouble? I can give you more trouble.
No, I think that'll be okay. So, but anyway, he says, Sansford usually comes in about, I don't know. He'll probably be here in about 30 minutes or so. I imagine he's expecting you. So, you know, anything you want to know about the area or anything like that? He's kind of desperate because all he gets to do is talk to people and farmers. So,
someone different is a blessing, huh? Someone different. Oh my God.
Cool.
Somebody different, thank God. He said, but.
Oh dear.
Well, I don't know. What's there to know about? Is that, like, what do you think? Any nice things? A couple of tourist sites? Anywhere I can get myself a good, first, a couple of fridge magnets back home?
Well, he sticks, the barkeeper thinks a minute, and he kind of scratches his chin and stuff, and he's jealous, like, well, you could always go around to the pool out back if you want to.
Might take a bit of a dip once we're done healing, yeah.
All right, sure, yeah. He points to the screen door there. You can see in the back there that there is a pond, actually, a small pond. It's surrounded by old retirees in speedos and bikinis just hanging out. Stuff like that.
Yeah. Oh,
and he looks over at Charlie and he says, yeah, just, you know, mind the croc out there.
Ah, no problem, mate.
Mm-hmm.
I will say, there was this little bit of Charlie just recoiling when seeing the many, many wrinkly bodies in very tight swimsuits. Just like, no, thank you.
Yeah, girls is totally not looking in that direction.
Just for funsie, Charlie, you want to roll me a perception, I guess, to check out the pool or something?
Yeah, give me one moment.
Okay.
That one, you just stare at the people again.
Mm-hmm. Let's make sure I'm rolling this in the right fucking channel, shall we?
Yes,
good, yeah.
Yeah.
That's a 15.
All right. Okay, you can see that there is, in fact, a green shoe, looks like it's made out of foam, that's floating there in the middle of the pond.
A green shoe.
Chelsea, I'm gonna kill you.
It has holes in it. It's just floating there.
Gently.
I hate this. God damn it.
Yeah, the barkeeper's like, yeah, he's like, oh, yeah, I know. The whole cow, he's like, yeah, that's the pub was named after that. You know, it's just, you know, it's always been there. I don't know. Everybody says to watch out for it, but it doesn't really do much.
Oh, well, just croc's kinda, a croc, ain't it?
Yeah, that's right. Exactly. Don't know where its mate is. No idea.
Someone else quick.
Right. Find the mate for the croc. all right. So anyway, about this time, the door busts open and you see a yuppian looking dude coming through the door. He's just like looking around. He's like looking around, seeing and he spots you through and he's like, oh God, let me see if I can do this. He's like, his face just like lights up in a grin. You think it's a grin. It's hard to tell. He's got kind of like squint. Unfortunately, I do not have a picture of him. I'm sorry, guys.
That's okay.
I will get a picture up for him. But his eyes are kind of squinty, and he's got a grimace that could probably be a smile, but it's just kind of like, ugh, you know, so he might be smiling. I'm not sure. He goes and then he's like, oh, it's so good to see you. I'm so happy to see you now. Look, look. Oh, you finally have gotten here. And now we can get started.
What is that accent?
Fantastic.
Amazing.
Abigail immediately puts out a wing like, put her here.
So good to meet you. I'm so happy to see you. And he goes and he shakes your hand. He's got big, beefy arms. He's a kind of a pretty big, beefy guy anyway. So he just goes around and he shakes all the hands and he says, you will not believe how much trouble we've been having out here with these guys. The farmers and the retirees, they are like at each other's throats on it. It's very ugly. You should see it, you know, just, oh. And then when you see the ones, the retirees, when they take their dentures out, you know that they mean business.
I don't think I want to see that. Thank you very much.
I know. So anyway. Okay, I got to look away from all that gallery because I'm gonna start giggling every time I look at it. So anyway, thank you, Liz. You're wonderful, but you also made me giggle nervously. Ranger says, So if you're ready, we will go ahead and we will get in the chopper. I mean the car. It's right outside. He's pretty happy to see you guys. And he says, I figured out, and he goes and he unrolls this map on the bar counter. And he says, I figured out where exactly the majority of these things are coming from. And it's right here in this area. He's got like a little area circled there. So he says, so we're going to try to head in that direction.
Oh, excellent. Abigail's like leaning over to look at this map.
Can I roll an investigation check on the map just to see Charlie can get a good lie of the land?
Okay. Yeah, similarly, Abigail would love to do like a perception if there's anything else that's been marked here.
Girls is going to join the perception crew.
Yeah, that's a 17 right. Investigation from Charlie.
Fucking that
one. Oh, that's pretty good.
I can't. Maps. It's always maps.
God, Kraken, it's maps and you. Do not mix.
It's not just Gregory. Oh, it's me. It's just...
I'm so sorry. The map is just pretty much, it shows the town itself, and then like a couple of miles out, there's like these little dots that are like marked across the map. You can tell that these are like, you know, the little X's and stuff, so it looks like that these are probably like either like sightings of their quarry or something along the lines of places of interest. But the main area seems to be focused on this area out here, way out here in the countryside that looks like it's just got a big red surround it. So it looks like that, you know, they're pretty determined to go in that direction there. So, but other than that, the map itself is like pretty ratty. So, that's pretty much it.
No, that's
Abigail fun. Nods like she understands exactly what she's seeing. Yeah. She does not.
So he jabs his finger at the big circle and says, we're going to want to have to start there, and we probably should get started right away because it's like a few hours away from here. But this right here, and he points to where the part of the little map circle there. He says, this right here, this is where they think that they're coming from.
All right, well, guess we better go stop them.
Seems all right to me. It can't be that much harder than wrangling, you know, all the kids back at Colony at home. Abigail's just going to finish the drink in one go.
Ranger looks over at Abigail, and he looks over at Charlie and the rest of them, and he's just like kind of like, you know, looking at them, and he's just like,
do you know anything about Goofus Birds?
Yeah, I wrote one or two in my life. Sorry.
What do we roll to find out if we do?
Would that be history?
Oh, yes. Charlie is just straight up lying. If you are welcome to try and roll insight on him to figure out if he is telling the truth.
But, what's his deception?
One guy's inside is.
Let's see here. Abigail would roll anything because she's just firmly confident that whatever these birds are, she's got it handled.
Yes.
Good liar, but goof on that roll.
Yeah, I like, look, a plus 10 won't save me when I only rolled a 2. They're like, all right, that's a 12.
It's a 21 on the insight. Is it nature or something to try and identify the birds? Animal handling? It's not.
Insight. What would I need? I would need to roll insight, though, wouldn't I?
Insight to parse the lie. Yeah.
Yeah. To see if it, all right.
So, like,
natural 20 plus
20. Yeah. So, Charlie has done like a semi-convincing, has done a semi-convincing lie. meets it, beats it. So, you got.
Everyone sees through.
Yeah, you kind of go like, semi-convincing lie. You know this man has never heard of a goofus bird in his life. He is a city kid.
He's like, city slicker right here.
Yeah.
I rolled nature to see what girls know about goofus birds. Not much. Not much.
Know about the name and stuff. And so a ranger kind of like sighs and he says, come on, let's go get in the Jeep. And I will explain to you on the way. They're not.
Gun.
They're not. They're bad news. Bad, bad news.
All right. Time to go hop into the ute, I guess.
Yeah. He's eyeing Abigail to try and find this shotgun that she pointed out.
Yeah, you guys, when you get into the Jeep, you can kind of tell it's been pretty much tricked out because whatever these goofus birds are, Ranger Sansford seems to be quite intent on taking them out because he's got practically a whole big arsenal in this stuff in this Jeep. There's barely room for y'all. So, it's just like packed, you know, just like sticking out the windows and stuff. And he's just like, yeah, you might need to move over some of that stuff. Watch the missile launcher there, but I mean it's on safety, but you know, I mean you probably should be careful of it anyway.
I now see the shotgun. Yeah.
I'm just gonna, because again he's a fucking thief. Okay, that's a 14. That's a sleight of hand. Question, were there any nice looking knives and or generally bladed weapons?
Why, yes, there was, in fact, a couple of very nice-looking Bowie knives with nice little inlaid bone handles and stuff like that. It's very, very nice.
Very pretty. Okay, well, they're probably not there anymore.
I'm going to roll to see.
If that's against passive, then Grills will see that.
Will Grills say anything, though?
Yeah, exactly. Oh, yeah.
Let's be real here.
All right, so perception. Let me see what if my man sees anything. Okay, he rolled 12, 13, 14. He rolled a 14.
Meets it, beats it. So I don't reckon it's. I think yeah, you possibly would see it. Then I'm not sure, generally, because it depends on who you're counting as meeting it. I think it would be you. Yeah.
Yeah, I guess. Okay. Well, I will say that you know he's. I will say he's got so many knives that he doesn't really notice. He like glances in the back and he gives the collection of knives a glance over there and he squints even more if that's possible. And he's just like, huh, I'm sure that I had at least 3-4 more knives. Huh. And he goes and he looks at them and he looks over at Charlie and he's just like, let's go ahead and get started. He's a little sus, but he's not gonna say
anything. Lee is just prepping for what's about to happen. That's nothing suspicious yes, there.
Exactly. So you're gonna go ahead and start the car, and they're gonna go get going down the road. And so anyway, that's where we're heading now. We're heading down the road, bumping along. It's really quite desolate out here. Just pretty much desert, scrubland, all that good stuff. And so he's Ranger has got like a very determined look on his face as he's driving, you know, and he looks over at them and he's just kind of like,
so you have never encountered Goofus birds before, huh?
No,
he's just talking to them in general.
Yeah, not as such, but like a bird's a bird's a bird, right?
No, a bird is not a bird is not a bird. Not these birds. They are bad birds. Bad. And he just shakes his head. He just continues. He just has a very grim look on his face. Like, you guys want to, like, you know, maybe poke him a little more about that. See, maybe you can get some more information. I don't know.
The very first thing before we get too far. So this image in my head, as they're leaving the town, Abigail mm-hmm. did yell at all the retirees. She could see just like, so long, fellow fossils. Yes.
She gets like maybe a few of them, like, you know, pulling their shades down and looking and just kind of like, huh, okay. Just put their shades back on. So.
Girls is just going to go ahead and ask, what makes Goofus birds so different?
They are man-eaters. They will eat you.
They what? Literally?
Man-eaters.
That's not ideal.
Consider, I'm not a man.
They will eat you anyway.
I don't think these birds have a gender preference for taste.
It's exactly right. And I know I've seen these terrible birds in action.
Now, when you say that, you're saying, like, they're actually carnivores and will eat, like, all the cattle around here, or are they, you know, just mean?
They will not bother the sheep, but they will not bother the cattle, but they will eat anything on two legs.
Right, keep that in mind then.
You have to understand these are deadly, deadly killers. And our job here is a very important one. We must eliminate them all.
And have they been running around?
They started coming here about the turn of the... Let's see. I'm trying to think. They started coming here about like a little bit last year when the rain started. So they started coming inland. Usually they stay outland. Then they started coming inland. And they have come and they have overrun the farmers' fields. The farmers. I have talked with them. I know. I tell them that they are man-eaters. The farmers are terrified. And they go and they have gone to Miami Beach to stay for safety until they know that I can take care of them.
Is there any surefire way to take one down? Or?
They are clever, cunning beasts. You have to be very, very, very careful.
Well, I mean, and Apple's glancing back at the apparently like missile launcher that's in the back. When you've got something like that, I don't think careful factors in there. You know, area of effect.
Yes, exactly. Bless them. Exactly. So you guys have been driving for like maybe an hour or so, and I want you guys to roll a perception check for me around the surrounding areas.
Oh, that's good. That's really good. Hell yeah.
Awesome.
These dice are a blessing.
18 from Charlie.
Mm-hmm. Oh. All right. Very nice. Okay. So, let's see. So, what you got, Abigail, you notice that there appears to be a cloud of blackish smoke coming up in the sky there sometime ahead of you. Charlie notices that the road is getting bumpier and rockier, and it's kind of like narrowing into like a ravine of some kind. Grills, you actually see that there appears to be a vehicle in the right turned over in the road with smoke pouring from it, and there appears to be two people there, and there is also a rather ominous noise.
That's terrifying. Did anyone else spot the vehicle?
Say that again.
Girls is pointing out what he saw.
Oh yeah.
It went. But you know, attention being drawn to it.
Mm-hmm. Alright, well that's not a good sign.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not. And Ranger, I'm gonna see if he notices it too. Might be a good idea. Alright, 20. Okay, yep, he does see 22. So he starts slowing the vehicle down and he's like, oh, that is not good. And he goes and he parks the car off to the side a little bit. And he gets out to go and he walks a little bit ahead there. While he's doing that, he has left his phone on the seat. And all of a sudden it starts going.
Yep.
Abigail's going to be nosy and pick it up.
I was going to say, yeah, if anyone else didn't get it first, Charlie is definitely going to try answering it.
Hello, this is Ranger's phone. How may I interrupt your call?
What? Who is this?
Ah, it's about his friend, Admiral Abigail. Hi, how can I do you for?
Look, is Ranger there?
And she kind of peeks out the window to wherever Ranger went. He's around.
Okay, listen, tell him I need him to, send snoots, okay? Lots of snoots.
You want nudes?
Snoots! Snoots, can't you understand me? Snoots!
Snoots.
And I will tell him to send as many snoots as possible, and I will give him a prize for them.
I mean, all right. We're a little busy at the moment.
All right. As soon as he can get to it, tell him I would appreciate it. Remember, tell him, send snoods.
Wait, hold on. Who's calling?
It's his friend Elmer. He'll know who I am. Click.
There are tears in my eyes.
Oh, Abigail just puts on the phone and looks at Leanne and growls and is like, Daddy, y'all know what snoods are?
Don't think I want to know, to be honest.
Girls just kind of offers a helpless shrug.
Alright.
So, can you still see Ranger?
Go ahead.
Abigail, like, leans out the window and just hollers at the top of her lungs. Ranger! Someone wants snoots!
What? They can't hear you! Talking to this gentleman here!
Snoots!
What? Snoots!
Cool, we're getting nowhere.
Yeah, it's okay.
There's gonna be some action happening soon. And he goes, he's apparently, what you can see is that he's down there where the vehicle is. It's overturned, it's completely blocking the road. And he seemed to be going down there to check out to see what was going on, but as soon as he did, he starts and hit you again, you hear that boo, 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 boo noise, and you see Ranger grab one of the guys and help him up, because apparently he's been injured, and the other guy, and they start like booking it towards the Jeep, and they're running just fast as they can. They're dragging the poor injured guy along with them.
Girl's just gonna run over to try and help because he's fast as fuck, boy.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, come on over here. All right, and you just from what you can see, I'm not gonna make you guys roll forward or anything, but from what you can see is that the Jeep is overturned. It's smoldering, and there appears to be two weird looking. Let me see if I can pull up my screen here, and I'll show you. Hang on a second.
It's here. Fully expecting some fucking like the Ted Road Runner mixed with Velociraptor monstrosity.
Oh boy,
yes.
God,
you see that?
Oh no, goodness,
it's not loading in. Come on,
oh my god.
Holy shit.
The opposite way eyes just make this.
Holy
the teeny
shit.
Tiny wings.
They are the creatures that are making the noise. And, well, they don't appear to be very vicious. They, in fact, are kind of like running around with their heads just sort of wobbling back and forth.
Now, important question. How tall are they?
They are running about, if what you can tell, looks like they're about 6 feet tall. They're
okay.
Pretty tall.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Twice the average height.
Girls are still tall.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly. So, about, yeah. They're running around in front of the Jeep. So Ranger gets back there, and he's just like, helping him, and he's like, oh, this is bad, and, and he goes, and he hands it over to the guy, and he says, and he looks over at the other guy, and he says, tell them what happened. And the other guy, who appears to be dressed up like a, I guess like a park ranger or something along those lines, they both appear to be park rangers. And he's just like in shock. He's like, he's just like breathing hard. He's just like, they just came out of nowhere. I saw, Jerry and I were in the car, and we're driving, and they just came out of nowhere, and we could stop them. They didn't have any fear. They just ran straight at the Jeep. He's just like kind of, he's a little bit hysterical right now, so.
This guy hurt? Does he need healing?
He's like, no, I'm fine. I'm all right. It's just, oh, Jerry, you got to look for Jerry there. I think Jerry broke his leg or something. He's not looking too good.
Girls is going to place Jerry as gently into the Jeep as possible. So many J yes. sounds.
Yes, so many J.
I was like clearing the way of weapons. There's no room in here.
Just shoving the weapons out the way there. Okay, he says, the other guy, I guess I'll call him Sam and Jerry, there you go. Sam is, and Ranger are talking, and Ranger's like, sits up, and he like looks over at Abigail, and he says, weren't you hollering something to me earlier?
Oh, yeah, you got a phone call.
Oh, I did? Who was it?
I didn't remember the exact name, so Abigail doesn't remember the exact name. Like,
wasn't it Elma or something?
Some Elmer Fudd kind of sounding name. Wanted Snoods.
Snoods! Oh, I know exactly who that is. Elmer is my friend. He's over in, outside of Miami Beach. He's like got a little hut there, but he's my Snood dealer.
Still not sure what that is. Still not sure I want to know.
Oh, you do not know what snoots are? Oh, well,
And then he goes and he reaches around and he pulls out a picture of the same goofus birds, except that they have been drawn to look ever so much more ferocious.
Oh, dear.
And he says, and he points to the big bear and he says, all right, do you see the little wobbly thing that's hanging down there? And he's pointing to the beak and the little gooble thing that's hanging down there.
Yeah.
All right, that is a snood. And I can tell you this right now. My man pays good money for every goofus bird snood he gets. He pays 15 gold for every single one that you can get from a goofus bird. So in addition to the money that I will be giving you in order to help me out with this, you will also be getting 15 gold piece for each snood that you can get from these beasts.
Sounds like a challenge then.
Oh, well. I'm just like rubbing your hand wings together.
Yes.
I don't know how I feel about this.
Lee going around and like pointing at everyone like, competition.
I'm going to do the exact same thing. Are they just looking at each other like, you?
Same brain cell.
Girls is just mildly disturbed in the background.
Oh, very important question for Sam is, I think before they get too wrapped up in the competition, it's like, yeah. All right, so let's, oh, one sec. Do you need healing or anything, mate? Because Charlie does have healing spells.
you're talking to Sam?
Oh, yeah.
Sam's just like shakes his head and he's like, I think I'm fine. I just want you to go ahead and take care of Jerry. We were just, he's calmed down a little bit. He says, we were just driving along, you know, because we were driving along, you know, doing our little scouting in the area, and they just came out of nowhere. And one of them took control of the Jeep. I think he had like mind powers or something like that. And he took control of the Jeep, and the Jeep flipped over and you know, and it's wrecked, and now we're stuck, and there they are. They're up there. See, you can look, you can see. They're waiting. The goofus birds are continuing to run around in circles, going blue, 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 blue.
Excellent. Is the other car still blocking the road?
Yes, it is. Okay. The goofus birds are in front. Okay, so basically what you have is the goofus birds are in front of the Jeep that is going, like, you know, smoldering and stuff like that. The Jeep has pretty much very much blocked the road, and the goofus birds are also in the way as well. So in order to unblock the road, it's looking like you probably are going to have to deal with the goofus birds.
Okay.
Grills is getting his tactics head on now, and looks at the other two and just goes, are you both spellcasters?
Yeah, bit of this, bit of that.
I am.
It'll be easy to show you. And he takes a step back and then sets himself on fire.
Oh. Yep.
Abigail's clapping.
Lee's just nodding, like, okay, yep, cool. Can get behind this.
I can draw their attacks if you can keep them from crowding me.
Sounds like plan.
You got it.
All right. Okay. Well, I guess we're going to roll initiative then and see who attacks who.
Oh, boy.
Oh, my God. These dice are so good. I love them so much. It's another 18. Nice. It's 22.
23 from Charlie. Yeah.
All right.
Abigail.
One. Lee. Rails. Abigail.
Oh. All right, 18. I got a 14 and 18 for the goofus birds as far as initiative goes. So, let me see.
Is the ranger partaking in this combat or no?
He's been talking with Sam. I think he's a little bit distracted, you know, because. Right. So.
And that, there we go.
All right. Cool. All right, Lee, Grills, Goof. Goof one, goof two. All right, thank you. That's why I was trying to figure out. Alrighty.
All right, I think, yeah, Lee's just going to start off like, all right, I think he's going to hold his turn for the moment because, all right, if you draw him attention, if I can get to the car, I reckon I can get out of the way with one shot. Sound like a plan?
Sounds good to me.
Yeah, so Charlie, Lee's going to hold his turn until after Grills.
Okay. Alrighty.
Girls is just gonna fucking run up, vault over the fallen truck, and start punching.
Alright. So, let's see here.
Alright. This is probably gonna be on goof one, I guess. Just pick one and start wailing on it. Alright, first hit. Oh my god. Hell yeah. Alright. Where the fuck nuggets is... Okay. So, first one is that much to hit.
Dang.
Then it's that much to hit, and then bonus action for a third attack.
Okay.
So that's 15 is the lowest.
Okay.
Nice.
I am going to see if the emu can dodge that. Let's see here. What is your dexterity, dumb bird?
Okay. If you're looking for armor class, the stat block will have it on it generally.
Yeah, I got it.
Elsewise, armor class is 10.
Your armor class, is 12. Okay, what I need to do, I think, is to, roll and see if they can avoid that.
No, if it's just against their armor class. If it's higher than their armor class, then they hit.
Okay. All right.
So,
because like armor class is a mixture of how tough they are / how good they are at dodging. So,
all right.
Yeah. Okay. So the first attack does move that out of the way. Not that yet. 3+. It says 4 points of bludgeoning and 3 points of bludgeoning, 1 point of fire. Mm-hmm. God. DA is not being so nice. It says, oh god, the dex modifier on top. Add another 4 points of bludgeoning damage to that. Okay, so that's 5 points of bludgeoning and 3 points of fire, and then the last hit is with his foot, because that's how that works.
Okay. Alright.
Okay.
And what I need to do is, I guess I need to roll higher than a 15, I guess, in order to dodge it, or?
No, it just hits. There's no dodge mechanic in 5e, unfortunately.
Oh, okay.
And the last hit does 7 points of bludgeoning and 3 points of fire.
Okay, alright. Okay, let's see here. So, basically, we're seeing how tough he can be here. How much he can handle it. Okay.
Yeah, so he's taking a grand total of 8, 16, 26 points of damage.
Okay, alright. Okay, your constitution is 12 plus 1. I rolled a 17, so that's 18.
The stat block should have HP as well.
Okay. All right. Say that again.
The armor class. The stat book should have their HP listed.
Okay. HP is. All right. Okay, their hit points are 19.
So... Oh, took that thing out there. That is on the ground.
Okay, nice. The goofus board is just like he looks from it and he's like bloop, like that. He goes over head over beak over heels and stuff, and he's down. So now we have other goofus bird.
It's Charlie, because he held his turn far after Grills.
Okay, all right, go ahead.
It basically just like shuffles me in the initiative. But yeah, it's what he's going to do is basically jump out of the Jeep, roll, run up, and try and position himself so that he's kind of crouching just underneath the nose of the upturned car. Because what he's about to do is cast Thunderwave, one of his absolute favorite spells, which, yeah, because it has the added effect of, any unsecured objects that are completely within the area of effect are automatically pushed 10 feet away from you.
How big is the area of effect on that?
It is a 15-foot cube.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
So, yeah, Charlie.
Same as this?
Yeah, pretty much. So, yeah, Charlie's kind of getting. He's specifically angling himself so the car isn't just a wet pushed away. It's kind of pushed up as well to completely try and flip it out of the way.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
that's what I think.
The remaining Goof of Spurred and Grills both have to roll for this. If my
quite likely, yeah, because you're like right next to the Jeep, you're right next to the car, aren't you?
Yeah. All right.
Is it a Dex or is it Con?
It is a Constitution save. Yeah.
Oh, nice. 20.
All right. Let's see here.
Well, I was gonna give you a luck point, but you know what? A 20s makes it, so you're good. But yeah. Goof of Spurred, make a Con save, please.
All right. I will do that. Okay, 16 plus 1 is 17?
17 makes it, so yeah, you will still you will still take half damage. I'm so sorry. Okay. He does not have spell slate shaping, but
so half damage for Goof of Spurred and half damage for
Grills. Okay.
For Grills, yeah.
So, good news is it was shit damage, so you're only taking 2 points of thunder damage.
That's good for Grills, but like, oof.
Alright, cool. Alright.
But at least the car gets, shoved out of the way.
There you go.
True.
Okay, Goof of Spurred number 2 is down to, what was it, 2 points you said?
Down to hit points.
Down to hit points, yeah.
That's, alright, so
he's 2 offense max.
Yeah, so he goes flying. He hits the side of the little ravine that they're in, and you know, he just stands up and he just like shakes his head and he's like, blah, 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 like that, and he looks at them and he just like is like wall-eyed, blinking at them in bewilderment, and it's. It's getting really, really hard to determine that this is a evil man-killing beast. But he has the Goof of Spurred goes and he like wobbles his head around and he looks over at his fallen friend there, and he goes over there and he wobbles over there to his friend and he just stands there and he's just like He's like trying to intimidate them, I think. So let's see if Let me see if this thing can intimidate.
This is flat car if it doesn't have proficiency.
Yeah, exactly. intimidation. Let me see here. All right. Intimidation.
This movement is like what happens when you wiggle a piece of plastic, like a plastic board. It goes
So that would be, let's see, to roll for that would be under charisma. Is that correct?
Yeah, D20 plus charisma modifier.
Okay, D20 plus charisma.
Right. These birds truly are Muppets.
Yes, they are. Oh, fun. And they actually have a -2 to charisma. So.
Not intimidating.
1, 2, 3, 8. He's trying. He looks like one of those like what you call it outside of the car dealer's place, the wibbly wobbly thing.
Wacky man flip long flame too bad.
Yes. It looks like one of those things.
I'm gonna say right
noise.
Lee has actively doubled over line laughing here.
I take it no one is intimidated.
Girls is just baffled.
Oh my goodness. Okay. So that was the Goof of Spurred number 2's turn. that's pretty much it.
Considering the way this seems to be going, Abigail is just like, nah, the fire's got this, and is going to try to just run past all this to get to, you know, the person who's sounds like they're injured.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that person is in the car.
They're in the car.
Wasn't there a second person?
They're also
There was Gary was injured. Sam is currently talking with Ranger, who I think is trying to sort of get him to calm down because poor guy's like hyperventilating. So,
all right, let's get snood.
You're gonna go and get the snood?
Yeah. There's a bird down. Abigail's getting the snood.
Look, if Grills isn't getting it, no point wasting it.
That's right. You know what, fair.
Get those snoots.
You know, you snooze, you lose.
You snooze, you lose.
What does Abigail need to roll anything to retrieve the snoot?
It just detaches. I think it's held on by Velcro.
Perfect.
Abigail's just like, ha ha.
It's you, never what. Oh my goodness.
That sounds like it would be her action, so she's been entirely unhelpful.
Astounding.
All right, so she took a snood from the fallen one, is that correct?
From the fallen one, yeah.
Okay, all right. The other one is like, he's just like still running around, his little head wobbling back and forth. You know, he's trying his best to carry y'all away, but it's not working. They're pretty pathetic little buggers.
Gods.
I love them.
Yep. Okay. Anyway, so I guess let's see. Whose turn is it?
Maybe back to Lee.
Yeah,
top of the initiative. Top of the order.
Alright.
Top initiative. Alright. Is that Lee or is that Grills? Did you push your turn all the way behind Grills, or just that?
I outright like held my turn, so technically we should swap in the order, so it'd be you first.
Okay. Alright, cool. Grills is gonna go over there. Try and wrangle a big bird. Okay. First one is 15? Yeah, 15 to hit. Second one is 19 to hit. Bonus action, third attack, 20-something. Should I assume we'll hit? Alright, my days. So it's 9 points of bludgeoning, 1 point of fire on the first attack. Ooh! We take that! Nice. 8. 12 points of bludgeoning and 1 point of fire on the second attack. And I think that would take it out, so couldn't his third attack just be pulling the snoot off?
Alright, sorry about that. Say that again, I'm sorry.
He did 10 points and then 13 points of damage, so can his third attack just be pulling the snoot off?
Probably, yeah. Makes a little Velcro noise.
That is deeply disturbing. Okay.
Well, if you don't want it, I'll have it.
Meantime, the poor Goofus bird just continues to run around in circles. And it's apparent that the whenever you take the snoods off, it does something to their balance. So the thing is runs around in circles for a few minutes and then just falls over.
Oh my god!
Whole thing,
waving his feet in the air and going blue in distress.
Right. Let's just hold on. Where'd my D10 go? There it is. God. Rolling hammer space for Grills is really fun because he's actually got double the chance to fumble.
Mm-hmm.
That's a 6 though, he's fine. He reaches into his sleeve, pulls out a little plastic bag and puts the snood in it, and then puts that in his jacket.
Alright, excellent. Snood for you, snood for you. Alright, so congratulations, you have defeated the Goofus Birds. Wow, that was... That was some battle.
Hell of a sentence.
Like,
I was on the edge of my seat there, you know?
Lee standing there, snoodless, and just like, oh, screw me for doing the practical thing, I guess.
Abigail grins and winks. Like,
for you.
It's your fault.
He's absolutely going to flip you the bird, Abigail, just so you know. Again, friendly competition. He is smiling here, but also he is going to flip you the bird.
Abigail just is laughing, grins, it's on.
Alright, excellent. Okay, so about that time, Ranger has finally managed to get Sam calmed down, and Sam and Ranger have noticed that you guys have defeated these ferocious Goofus Birds, and Sam is just like, he looks over at y'all, and he looks over at Ranger, and he says, He says, "Wow, you really chose the right people for the job. Look how they took care of those vicious beasts." And Ranger just like nods his head, like he's like, "Yeah, yeah." He's like, I definitely picked the right people. They took them out. Thank God." Oh.
Girls like opens his mouth and then thinks better of it and shuts it again.
I know, it was a hard and arduous battle, perhaps one of the worst I've ever fought, but I prevailed. Thank goodness you did. Nothing to the birds.
You took them both out before they could get you.
With my bare hands.
I know, and you each have a snood. Excellent. So anyway, the poor goofus birds, which I'll say that you knocked the one goofus bird out, and the other one is still kind of like going around in circles. It's pretty pathetic. And Ranger goes over there and he grabs it by the neck and he lifts it up and he's holding it by the neck, and the thing is like its eyes are bugging out. It's like,
what are you doing?
I have such an urge to kill this beast. Look at its eyes. Because he takes and he sticks it in front of him. He says, "Look, that is the eyes of remorsefulness."
Ranger, I don't think it can do anything much anymore.
Pretty sure those are just the eyes of an idiot.
There's a difference?
Oh no, you don't understand. You have not seen what I have seen with these beasts. He's just like, he wobbles the thing's head and it's just like,
I think it's going to do any further damage.
Okay. That's right, because I'm going to take care of it right now. And he goes and he pulls out a big knife. So if you guys want to kind of like, whoa.
Yeah, girls are going to try and grab the dude.
No, I was going to say. So with a nat 20 plus 10, that makes a 30 for sleight of hand. What knife?
Yeah. Oh my God.
What knife?
Person, go ahead, Charlie.
Nice. So I guess like Charlie did a little stealthy sleight of hand and the knife was just like, whoop,
pretty much like within the motion of like Ranger grabbing it down, like grabs onto the handle in the motion of lifting it up, then he gets his hand to the top and it's just like a little blink blink of nothing there. Little outline.
Oh, Ranger just, he's like, he's coming down because he's ready to kill this thing, right? And he comes down and he's just, and it just kind of like bounce, his fist just bounces off the thing's face with a little squeak noise. And he looks at his fist and he says, you see how deceptive and clever these beasts are. It took my knife and it didn't even have a chance, and... The goofus bird at that point goes pip and he hits him, hits Ranger on the hand, and Ranger of course drops it and then the thing runs off.
Okay.
Oh wait. So.
Girls just like pinches the bridge of his nose and sighs.
I also just want to clarify, like Abigail and Grills, you do not know that it was Lee that took the knife. You just know it went missing. So like,
yeah. Like they don't know who took it, but he's pretty fucking sure it wasn't the dumbass bird.
Yeah. All right. So
Abigail, on the other hand, believes it was the dumbass bird, and her respect has just grown slightly.
Abigail is just looking in awe at the dumbass bird. Like,
the bird has probably fallen on its face at least twice, getting away because
yes, exactly. Its food is gone, so now its sense of balance is completely off.
We've all seen her decks.
Just fucking yes. Slay looming about everywhere.
Okay.
I do actually. Like, I will just say, Lee's just kind of gonna give the thing up and just go, "All right, Ranger, you're right. You see, the tricky things indeed. We've definitely got to be careful with it. Mind if I take my friends to the side for a little bit so we can, strategize and all that?"
That's no problem. I will go and talk to Sam to make sure that he and Jerry are okay and ready to, and if they need any help getting back to Miami Beach.
So he goes off to Jerry and them, so you guys can discuss your stuff.
Yeah, Lee is going to like throw his arms over the shoulders of both Abigail and probably not Grills, because Grills is too tall, but like...
Yeah, Grills is almost 7 feet.
Like, the intent is there, so kind of going into doing the whole head leaning in, doing a huddle, and just going like, right, so what we've got there is a dangerous idiot. I just came out to get my hands on some bloody pottery here. I'm doing fucking fetch quests here, there, and everywhere. I don't think that what this guy wants is a good idea. Your thoughts?
They seem harmless. The birds, I mean, not him. He's got quite the armory.
Yeah, no, I'm inclined to agree. Them goofus birds, you know, it's in the name. They're goofus. I've seen, like, some of the adopted Muppetborns up back at the colony have a bit more sense.
Yeah, well, we haven't seen much of them yet, so after all, could be wrong, could be more dangerous in groups. It's an idea to keep our guards up, but I reckon it's an idea to keep our guards up as much about them as it is about him, nodding back at the car.
Yeah.
Smart, smart.
Yeah, no, keeping an eye on that ranger, that's...
Do either of you have any potential ways to keep him still, silent, something like that?
Got a whole person.
I reckon we can figure something out. And Charlie's just now just kind of like, he's pulled out the fucking knife that he just stole and is just kind of juggling it in one hand, doing the thing where he catches it on one finger, flips it, catches it on one finger, and flips it again.
I love Charlie so much. Oh,
he's showing off.
Goofus stole it from him and you stole it from the goofus.
No, I stole it from him. Like, I stole it from him. Like, you don't seem to be the sharpest knife on the block, do you, Sheila? No offense.
Hey now. Just because it's true. Sharp snap bloke over there points thumb back over at Ranger.
That's not a knife, that's a hunk of unworked metal.
Still good for bludgeoning. Still dangerous, but worth keeping an eye on.
Yes.
Alright. Okay. All right. So you guys, are you finished with your huddle or?
Yeah. I think we're done.
Yeah.
Okay. So about that time, Ranger comes over and he says, "All right, Sam and Jerry are going to head back to Miami Beach, and we are going to go ahead and get in the Jeep, and our destination should be up there. It should be a couple more hours, and we will get there."
Road trip.
Sounds good.
There you go. All right, sure. And they hop in the car, and away they go. So, there's a couple hours pass, and it is starting to get a little dark, because they got there at Miami Beach, they got there probably about, I don't know, midday or something like that. So, now it's starting to get a little bit dark. When they finally go, and let me see if I can pull up my thing here.
Want it known that Abigail did instigate a game of I Spy, and it was terrible.
Sounding like a cliche D&D player, Grills does have dark vision.
Very nice.
But also, okay. When it gets dark enough, he'll just use Genasi produce flame to keep a flame lit, so people can stay.
Yeah.
No. Okay, so I'm going to pull up this incredibly detailed map that I made. You can see the detail is just incredible.
Oh, can't wait.
Let's see here. So, I'll pull it up here. So, basically, after a while, now you guys see the road up there on your right hand side. That's the road that you guys are going to be coming in. So, you guys pull up to what looks like a very large fenced in piece of land. There is an old rotten two-story farmhouse in the middle of this piece of land. It's surrounded by a wooden fence. There appears to be a gate at the front of where you guys are heading. And if somebody wants to roll perspective to see if you can see how many
Jolly, I just have to say, how long did you spend on this map? It's absolutely gorgeous.
I know, my detail. God. Hours.
God. Could just telling you. Zooming in.
Oh, that is so many goofus birds. Holy shit.
All right, that's already a 4 for perception for Jolly.
All right, excellent. Yeah, it's beautiful.
Oh, goodness.
I'm just waiting for the goofus birds to swarm the veranda. Yes.
The tree, right. I think, is the piece de resistance on this map. Yeah. That's great. I love that.
Yes, exactly.
Wait, okay, why is a 16 the highest? That is Purser, please.
Yeah, no.
All right. So, anyway.
I'm sure they're deep in their game of Terrible I Spy. Don't worry about it.
Yes, exactly. So, anyway, basically, Grills is the one that sees there is a heck of a lot of goofus birds here. There is actually, let me see, I can't remember how many I had. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. There are 16 goofus birds all together, just kind of wandering around. You also notice something else. They seem to be wandering around in specific areas of around the house. Like, they seem to be sticking to certain areas of the house. So, So you guys pull up the Jeep and you stop right at the gate and you get out. And Ranger is, of course, looking out at this, and you see that a little flicker of emotion passes over his face for a second, and then he's gone.
Oh! Hey, yeah, what the fuck is that emotion?
Abigail is also inciting.
Yep, I think
it was. Oh, Nat 20.
Yeah. Oh, very nice. Okay. You can tell that emotion, it's a strange blend of anger and nostalgia.
Interesting. All right. Okay. Girls is very obviously giving the ranger a strange look.
Yes, exactly. Well, he looks over there at the other ones and he says, "We are going to have to be careful. You can see how many there are there. And no doubt that the crafty creatures are going to wait to ambush us. So we must proceed with caution." So, the gate is closed. If any of you guys want to try to open it.
Hold on, before I proceed, how many people here can see in the dark?
Silence.
Yes, silence.
Just me. All right. Do you have any way of lighting up your surroundings, or are you reliant upon this flame?
Charlie does actually have, like, a candle in his hammer space that he could pull out, and also prestidigitation, just sending up a constant fire of sparks and mini fireworks would potentially work.
There is the daylight spell.
Oh my god.
I have no intention of using up a fucking spell slot for this.
Yeah, Abigail neither. Abigail's fine to stumble in the dark.
Girls, once again reaching into his sleeve. We'll see how well this goes. I'm gonna get my fucking dice out. Here we go. Oh, fuck. God damn it. It was a 2.
F.
Where the fuck is the fumble chart? There it is. He pulls out a bar soap. That's. No. Puts it back. Oh, 9. Hell yeah. Cool. Pulls it, which lights it, pulls it out for someone to take.
I just checked Abigail's items just to make sure I wasn't forgetting anything. This does not help here, but I forgot I bought the kitchen gun.
Yes!
Yes!
Excellent. Oh, the chaos.
I love you, kitchen gun!
Yes! Love you, kitchen gun! Okay, so you guys are what is it exactly you're doing? I'm trying to
Grills is holding out a torch for someone to take. Yeah, because he can see fine in the dark, but apparently you tunes can't.
Yeah, Charlie grabs his own candle. I'm like, I'm all right, mate. Don't worry about me.
Okay,
Abigail will take the torch. It's being offered.
Okay, so gate is in front of you. It looks like it's just a pretty standard latch. It doesn't appear to be locked or anything. So if anybody wants to open it and proceed, you can.
Rather than opening it, can Lee go vaulting over it instead? Because opening it may cause havoc. At least this way, vaulting over it means there's no way for the Goofus Birds to get out. This.
Lee, handshake, Grills, same idea.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
Acrobatics.
Yes, you can do that.
Charlie gets a crit fail.
Yes.
Now I could theoretically, I could use a luck point here. I'm not going to because this is hilarious.
14. Oh, sorry, not a 14. Okay. 19. I can read. 19 plus 4. 23.
Yep. Okay. So, Charlie, what happened? Did you attempt to vault over the gate and this?
I think what happens is, because I'm going to reflavor the candle as just like a classic storm lantern kind of thing. And so what he does is he gets ready to parkour his way over this gate, completely forgetting that he already has something in his hand, goes to like grab onto it to scramble his way up. The lamp goes crashing into it. Glass breaks. Charlie gets a foot up and then notices his sleeve is on fire. And then mid-air backflip backwards and then splat face first onto the ground. And all of y'all saw that.
Beautiful. That is beautiful, Kai. And I think that the gate is still closed, but does anybody want to do like a quick investigation check for me right quick?
Yeah.
7.
What is
all right?
So, yeah, 7.
Lee still has a face full of dirt. He can't see shit.
Okay. All right. So when all of that excitement happens, Grills, Charlie's obviously preoccupied, but Grills, you hear a very odd noise that sounds like.
Don't like that.
Grills is immediately bringing his hands up. He's not letting himself on fire yet, but he's got his hands up ready, quarterstaff in hand, looking around.
So, anybody else want to try? To open the gate.
Abigail had rolled earlier athletics for it and got a 13.
Okay. All right.
That's how you don't do it.
All right. Go 13. Okay. Well, that should be enough to open the gate, I guess.
She's trying to climb over.
Oh, she's trying to climb over? Okay. All right.
It's not the most graceful thing.
All right. Okay. Cool.
Or it's like Grills. A hop and a flap to fly over.
Grills just plants a hand and like swings his legs over. Charlie does that. Abigail has to climb.
All right. Okay. And
we left Charlie behind.
It's fine. Right.
We forgot our boy.
Our it's boy. Fine. Get our boy!
Get our boy!
All right, let's see here. Let's see. I'm looking. Okay. So I need you guys to. I need you to roll a saving throw, please.
Which one?
Dexterity, I think.
Oh no!
Oh yeah!
Oh no!
Oh, that's a zero.
Oh boy!
Abigail, baby.
Oh dear.
And Grills, what happened to Grills?
Grills got the opposite. Grills is fine.
Grills is fine. Yeah, Grills is
again, nat 20.
Okay, so anyway, you two hop over the gate, and Charlie, I'm assuming you're still trying on the other
side. I think by the time that the other two land like on the other side, Charlie is peeling mm-hmm. himself off the ground. So he can look through the gate and see what's going on with them.
Okay. All right. Well, Grills lands on the other side of the gate just fine. And Abigail, as she vaults over the gate, all of a sudden the ground disappears from under her and you hear what? A click. Oh and it comes back up again.
Wait, can I try and like grab her? Because I rolled a natural 20.
That was a nat 1. Also, Abigail just might be gone.
That's true.
Oh, she's just dead. She's picking dead.
Charlie and Abigail are both dead. It's all
if I had a penny game that I've been in with Kai.
God bless you. Since you rolled a 1, what happens is that apparently the ground has swung up and swung back again. There is a click, and it is whatever you have jumped into a pit that is designed to lock after itself, and it's about 10 feet down.
Amazing. Excellent. Fantastic.
You might need to roll damage.
If I had a penny for every game I've been in with Kai where someone has fallen through the ground because it disappeared beneath them, I'd have 2 pennies.
Which isn't much, but it's weird that it's happened twice.
I'm not playing a monk both times.
So,
exactly.
Basically
what happened was is all of a sudden when Abigail jumped over the fence, it's like when she landed on the ground like swung up. She goes whoop, and then it swings back and goes click, and now it's nice and locked.
Full damage in D&D is a D6 per 10 feet, if I remember correctly. So if it's 10 feet, then it's a D6.
Exactly.
Let's see what we get.
Yeah.
Is it doubled because she got the nat 1? Is that how we're doing this?
Do you want me to do that?
I'm asking you. I think this is hilarious.
Sure. Yeah, we'll say that.
Abigail eats shit like Charlie before her, face first on the fucking ground.
Excellent.
10 HP down.
Mm-hmm.
Oh boy.
All right. In the meantime, I think like the Goofus birds are just. If I didn't explain it earlier, I will say that the Goofus birds appear to all be like sleeping. They're like standing up. They're all asleep. So I don't know if I need to roll to see if you guys have made enough noise to wake them up or what.
You could probably just do like a straight D20 roll to see how much noise we've been making.
Yeah,
see,
exactly.
You know, if any of them wake up and how many, that sort of thing.
I have rolled a 12. So let's see what these guys. Okay, let me check and see what the perception is on these guys I have written down. Okay. And so their perception, they have a +4 to prefer perception.
Oh my goodness.
Passive senses perception 14, I think.
Ooh, yeah, they would have heard us then.
Yeah, baby.
It's all on Grills.
All right, I will say the ones that are closest to the gate all of a sudden go woo, and they look and they open up their eyes and they look around, but it's dark. They're not gonna see you.
Is Grills on fire?
No, Grills like... specifically not lit up yet.
Cool. Yes,
and the torch that was with Abigail is now on the pit. And would it be fair to say that the candle got put out when it ate shit? I guess
Charlie's lamp definitely died. So what I love is now technically the only person who isn't somewhat safe here is Grills, and Grills is the one that can see in the dark. So like we're in an all right situation here. Yeah,
we are so competent, you guys.
Grills just notices this.
I'm so proud of you.
That That's a 15, which I think beats their passive. So he just goes still and quiet.
Amazing.
Just okay, that's fine. So yeah, there's
like crouch from where he landed, just still and quiet. Like if I don't move, maybe they won't see me.
Never mind.
All right, let me see. Currently, there's like, I will say those three over there, 1, 2, 3, the three that are closest to you are the ones that just all of a sudden go, and they open up their eyes and they look around like they clearly have heard something and they're on the alert. But after a few minutes, as everybody's gone quiet and everything's still and everything like that, are like, huh, okay, and they yawn and they close their dumb little wall eyes back again and they're back asleep. I'll give you guys that.
Okay, excellent.
So meanwhile, Abigail is at the bottom of a pit. Grills is playing freeze with the goofus birds, and Charlie, where's Charlie at? What you doing, Charlie?
I think Charlie is going to take another go at climbing over the fence. He's going to be bit more careful this time.
All right, go for it.
Yeah, 13. It's not fancily done, and he goes very slowly because I think while this is going on, considering that the goofus birds almost woke, he is going to be specifically going stealthily as well. That was a 26 for stealth.
Very
nice.
Good job.
Rogues, baby.
All right. Okay, so now you guys are over the fence, but Abigail is at the bottom of a pit.
Okay, can we, Charlie's gonna like just kind of crouch down and start patting around in the dirt, trying to find the edge of the pit or the edge of whatever's covering the pit.
Okay, alrighty.
Just look over, grab, gently take Lee's hand and guide it to where the pit was.
Yeah.
Because he saw it and can see.
Let's see. Roll me an investigation check.
Okay. Can I have
with advantage? Because I'm helping.
Thank you. I'll give you that. Yep.
Yeah, roll again.
Yep.
Ooh. We'll take the 8.
No, that's an 8. Cool. No. this is a well hidden pit.
You're sure you saw Abigail around here somewhere, but it was like all of a sudden the ground just kind of like swallowed her up and there's not a trace of her anywhere.
Okay, one moment, I've got something else then. She's just fucking gone. I think there's just going to be a moment of, I was like, sod this. Charlie is going to pull out yet another knife out of his hammer space, but not just any knife, a special knife, specifically the cake knife.
Yeah.
Oh my god!
And he is just going to stab it into the ground.
All right. Nice.
So specifically, it works for up to 1 square meter of area. So like, so not 1 square, one cubed meter. So turning the lid of this trap into cake.
You suddenly create a Minecraft cake.
Yeah, pretty much.
It has turned into a delicious, I don't know what kind of cake it would be.
It's gonna be a shit cake. It's gonna be mostly fondant.
Gross.
That's not a cake, that's just sugar.
Yeah, I know, but that's how these cakes work.
Yeah, that's right. All right, excellent.
They're not even good cakes.
Okay, all right. So, Charlie is just going along, stabbing the ground, making it cake as he goes along. And I'm gonna be nice and say that you did in fact find the lid of it, which automatically turns. All of a sudden, there's like a big giant square of fondant in front of you, a very large square of fondant where it was. And I will tell you this, because the thing that I had down for that, it's a type of a locking pit. And you would have either had to do a 20 strength check or a 15 dexterity check from the person that was inside the pit, or a 10 perception or investigation spot, which I think, you know, you pretty much covered it. So,
yeah.
But you have turned the top of the trap into cake. So.
We have solved the pit puzzle.
You have solved it into cake. And hey, maybe now we've got something we can feed to the birds to distract them while we're doing something
else. That's true.
But yeah, so Charlie just takes, sorry, Lee grabs big old handfuls of this cake type ground and just scoops it up to hopefully uncover Abigail.
Grills is keeping an eye on the bird, ready to leap into action should they actually get aggroed.
Yep, all right. Okay, in the meantime, Ranger, who was, I don't know, like, trying to pick the right weapons, I guess, for to take on these vicious birds. You know, he goes over there. He was, in the meantime, while all this stuff was going on, he's looking through his weapons and stuff. Because you got to pick just the right one for these vicious man-eating birds. So he comes up with, like, a... I don't know. We'll say the missile launcher. We'll say the missile launcher. Yeah, I know. Yes. And he goes and he goes. He kicks open the gate to go in. And at that very instant, I'm going to see if that. What happens here?
Wait, aren't we stood right in front of the gate?
Yeah.
Huh? Yeah.
It just, like, smacks into you guys.
Smack. And not only that, okay, I rolled a 10. So let's see. The gate definitely does open, and all of a sudden you hear that little, you know, that little from earlier?
Oh no.
Well, it goes snap. You hear something distinctly snap, and then all of a sudden a giant air horn blares out.
Blah! Oh gods.
And let me see if that wakes the goofus birds.
I mean,
I think it would.
For fuck's sake.
Oh yeah, let's see. 16. Okay, let me see.
There is a crackling, growling hiss in primordial from girls right there.
And I don't find them good. Yeah. Well, I'll say it's, yeah, we definitely. So at that very second, every single one of the goofus birds' heads pop up, and you hear this overwhelming sound of blah, 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 and these birds all start running.
Oh, no.
And it takes a second for you to realize that they are panicking. And they are, running around the house. And you guys have created a goofus bird vortex, rather much like a chicken vortex.
If I had a nickel for every game that I've been in that has featured a vortex of very stupid animals.
There are several goofus birds that are running around the house in a vortex going... And there's, how many did I say there was? It was 15 of them?
16, I think.
16. Yeah, 16. All right. Yeah, 16 goofus birds are going around the house, around and around and around the house in a blind panic. So, let's see here. You guys have not got close enough to them yet, I think, to do anything. But I think you guys are probably going to have to be careful because these birds are they're panicking and they are pretty much in stampede mode. So, which I looked it up and it says this, a frightened herd flees a group in random direction, but they literally run over anything of size larger or smaller that gets in their way, and it deals 6 1d12 points of damage for every 5 creatures in the herd, and you have to do a dexterity save of 17 or higher, I think, in order to get past them. So basically, yeah, you got a stampede, you got a goofus bird vortex going around the house, and you're gonna have to be careful.
Excellent.
All right,
are all the goofus birds in this vortex?
Yes, they are all in it. He woke up every single last one of them. And they panicked, and now they are running around the house in a blind panic.
God, girl's just gonna fucking pop up to stand in front of Ranger. Like, what are you doing? Don't.
Oh, he goes in there. It says he looks. He's like oblivious to what Grills says, and he looks over at the vortex, and he says, "Look,
They are gathering their power to zap us.
Pretty sure they're just panicking, you moron.
Can I have a roll to get out of the pit?
No, no, you can see the intelligence in their beady little eyes. They are planning something. We must be careful.
Those eyes are anything but beady. can you help Abigail out of the pit?
Yeah, Charlie's still on that. he's just gonna like reach down a hand and go like, oi, Abigail, come on.
Mm-hmm. Yep, Abigail's gonna flap her wings and make that jump.
Yep.
So all right. We'll make that.
I better do a fucking athletics roll here, really.
Yeah. Ranger, athletics is better.
Yeah, Ranger's like, you see, you fell for one of the cunning traps.
Nice.
You have to proceed carefully. There could be more.
Abigail takes the leap, and Lee also grabs the arm, and just Abigail bursts out of the fondant.
You are now covered in cake.
There you go.
And she goes to take like a bite, like, but then realizes it's all fondant, and there's like an absolutely betrayed look at Lee.
Trust me, not my choice.
All right. But he says, yeah, the Ranger's like watching them. He goes and he's like, they're apparently circling. There must be the leader, must be inside of the house there somewhere. They are trying to protect it.
They're panicking. You startled them.
No, no, you can see there's intelligence behind this. Look, see how they are going in the same direction.
Because they're morons and following the tail in front of them.
No, wait. All right.
I can tell you, we're not actually all that smart. I'm an outlier.
No, I was going to say, I reckon the guy's got a point. I reckon here, we've got to have a plan. Wink. Please roll insight with advantage on Lee here.
Excellent.
Good, because that first one was a 5.
Oh, boy.
Second one was not better.
Oh, boy. Oh, God.
Dear.
Okay, I've got a... One moment. I'm gonna try and
11.
Do... What I'm going to do here, I think, is a fucking anti-persuasion roll, if that makes any fucking sense. I'm gonna do a d20 minus my persuasion, or...
Oh, my God.
And God...
It takes you guys a second because you think that you have this one like quick moment of, oh shit, what if Lee has joined the moron side? Then you realize, wait, no, he's gone.
Abigail winks back, but Lee can't tell because one eye is already X'd out.
Excellent. Okay. Lee pulls a rope out of his hammer space, tosses one end over to Grills and goes, you take this, then we'll have a go at tying this lot up, shall we?
Okay. Do you want him to fucking run to the other side of the house?
No, I was gonna say. How much you get here is up to you. The aim here is to pretend to be about to try and tie up the goofuses and tie up the actual moron that we are dealing with here.
Oh, okay.
That is what the aim is.
Nice, I love it.
Grills fucking catches the wink. It takes a moment because he's not familiar with such tunish shenanigans. Grabs the rope and then turns around. Oh, that's a crit.
Good crit or bad crit?
Does a 27 hit Ranger?
Nice. I'm gonna roll him just to see out of curiosity if he can figure out what's going on.
He'll only get a fucking split second.
I'm just curious.
Before
split second realization before. Gotcha.
Yeah, exactly. All right, let's see here. All right. That's a 3 plus 2. That's a 5.
Thank God. I think like those two act, Abigail jumps straight up into the air to avoid being caught in it.
Yep, perfect. I was going to say.
Fly the short distance and land.
Yeah, Charlie got a fucking nat 20 as well on sleight of hand. So I think, Ranger does not even notice until Charlie has finished tying the prettiest bow of rope on top of his head.
Fucking Grills grabs the end of the rope, turns around, and then immediately whacks the ranger over the head with his quarterstaff.
Yes! Oh my goodness. Oh, I'm sorry. Do I need to roll to see?
I think
how much damage does that do?
17 points of damage. Oh, jeez. Actually, you know what? I'm gonna spend a key point on this. Make me a con save.
Okay, all right. Yeah, I'm gonna do that. All right, let's see here. Oh, let me see. What is your constitution, dude? He's 17.
Damn it.
Yes, yeah, so what is he like? Bonks him on the head, and he looks over and he's like, "What are you doing?
Why did you care of the problem?" Abigail's gonna like make a motion to have one of the ends handed to her, and she's like, she just wants to tie the end of it to the fence.
I mean, yeah, there's yeah. Even after the pretty bow that is keeping Ranger there, there's still enough work.
Yep.
Fucking baby leash.
Baby leash. Abigail's just like, and one anchor band for you. Ain't going nowhere.
Ranger is struggling in this. He has this look of like absolute betrayal on his face. And he's just like, he's like, no, they have mind controlled you. I knew it. You are with them. Oh no. He's just.
No, mate, you got it wrong. They've mind controlled you. This is all just one big hallucination.
I can't believe it. You were with them the whole time. I cannot believe it.
This is all Ranger, a dream.
I gotta be real. I cannot turn against my brethren.
Oh, I'm gonna try. Okay, I wanna try to see if I can do maybe a strength check to see if he can break out of this, but I'll do it like just do it once and then I'll let you guys deal with it.
I think it's you need to get like a 15 or higher to break the break rope.
Okay. What kind of rope is it? Is it hemp?
Yeah, just plain hemp.
All right, let's see here.
I believe it's 15.
Yeah, DC 17. Oh, 17.
He attempted to do it, and he's just like looking desperate now. He's like, no, no, you don't understand. Fight the mind control.
What did these birds do to you that you hate them so much?
Oh my goodness. Oh, he hangs his head down like that whenever he says that, and he says, fine, I will confess to you. I despise these birds because they ate my mama.
What?
Is this your mama?
They ate my mama when I was but a little boy.
Bullshit.
Yeah, hold on. Oh, fuck. That was an insight. Grills is squinting in confusion.
Abigail didn't get any better.
Oh god, I gotta do.
Yes.
Yeah. No, Charlie's.
Well, it sounds like bullshit, well, but the man is clearly strong.
Absolutely sincere about this. You know, he's just he really honestly believes that these goofus birds hate his mom. He's like, I was just a child of five, and we always set the bird by goofus birds, and my mama taught me to run, and I ran, and I looked back, and all I could see was the goofus birds all over, and then I know that they ate her.
Do you have any proof that they did? Did you go back and find her body?
They left nothing. They didn't even leave bones. All they left was her little bow.
Then how do you know they didn't just take her away?
I know for a fact that they did that because they are vicious, vicious birds.
I don't know. Morons.
I'm not gonna get anywhere on this.
I don't know if you can persuade him. Oh my goodness.
God.
Is the goofus spiral still happening in the background?
Yeah, the spiral is still happening.
Cool.
Yeah, basically, yeah, they're all circled around the house. I mean, you can see my beautiful, glorious, detailed map right there.
guys. Absolutely. If you guys want to figure out, you know, if what you want to do.
Lee's just gonna kind of go like, okay, he wants to call bullshit on this story, but obviously this man believes it. He's just kind of gonna throw up his arms and go like, right, well, go over to scoop up some of the cake from the trap door and kind of just toss it at one of the goofus bird's heads to try and get their attention in a non-harmful way.
Okay. All right, let's see here. So you toss the cake. I'm gonna see, what would it, do I need to roll something to see if it would hit or something? Like,
no,
or
I would,
perception,
let me, I was gonna say let me roll dexterity just to kind of see if it does hit. Let's roll a d20 rather than a d10. So that's a 23. Oh,
yeah, so that hits.
My aim's pretty good.
this good thing this isn't your ex-wife.
Alright. And
meals up. Come on, kids. Feeding time.
Well, you see the one goofus bird, he gets splatted in the face with it. And he like kind of like stumbles out of the line and stuff. And he's just looking around bewildered because he's got cake on his face. He can't see anything. Everybody, all the rest of them are going, there's like a giant wave of.
Can either of you speak with animals?
No.
Good question, actually.
I'm not freaking Ellie.
I don't believe Abigail can.
Come on, you oversized canaries. Come on.
That's big with dead.
I should probably roll animal handling here.
Yeah, probably.
Are you gonna try to roll animal handling?
I'm gonna roll animal handling. I'm specifically. I'm gonna burn a luck point on this to give myself advantage.
Okay, good.
Go for it.
That's a 17.
Mm-hmm.
So,
all right, yeah,
feeding time.
Very nice. All right, let's see here. And does it work? Now, what would I need to roll in order?
I would say you wouldn't even, like, you can roll stuff if you want, but otherwise, like, you can just interpret a 17 how you think would fit for the story here.
Okay. All right. Okay. Well, let's see. All right. So, Lee rolled a 17. Lee, what are you doing to get the attention of this thing?
He's just kind of like, he's scattering bits of, kind of like crumbs of cake all over the ground.
Okay, alright. The thing is, like, he's still looking around because he's like, bloop, 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 bloop,
bloop. He's trying to get, like, the attention of the whole herd of goofus birds rather than, like, this specific one. It's just like, hey, look, get your attention. Come on, food over here, food over here.
Alright. Okay, so he's trying to get the attention all of them. Okay, I'm gonna roll perception, see if they notice.
Okay.
So. Alright. Oh boy, it's 2, 3, 4. It's a 6.
Oh, they're that stupid. They're that stupid.
They're in that much of a panic.
Oh, they're in that much of a panic. You have the vortex of goofus birds running around the house, and you have the one goofus bird who's apparently still got cake on its dumb little face. It's still trying to figure out where it is, I guess.
All right, I'm gonna try one last thing, seeing as Charlie notices that isn't working, and he's gonna do like an acrobatic fucking flip. And because that's a 12. Is that? Do you think his 12 is high enough that he can ride the goofus bird?
Oh my god, you're gonna choke about this?
Yes.
You know what? I'll allow it.
Yes.
Because I really want to see Charlie ride a goofus bird.
Yeah, so just like this one that's just wandering around unable to see shit because it's got cake in his face. He's just like, right, cool. Well, you know what? I said I'd had a go at riding these things before. Why not? Jumps up. And he's now on a goofus bird.
The goofish girl goes boom in panic and it takes off.
Yep. Okay.
Its dumb head is just like wobbling back and forth as it runs.
Yeah, Charlie
is here flapping in the breeze.
Charlie is doing his best to keep a good grip on this thing. I've got to ask, what are Abigail and Grills doing as this is going on in the background?
Grills, how much has the vortex kind of descended as the birds come over to feed?
They didn't come to feed.
They're still in panic, rolling around.
Okay. In that case, then. What was the check to try and get through the vortex? Is it a dex save or just a dex check?
Hang on a second. Let's see here. All right. So the danger here is that they are stampeding. You get trampled. You need to do a dexterity save of 17 or higher, it looks like.
Oh, nice. All right, cool. That makes it. That's a 12 plus 7.
Excellent.
Can instead of trying to go through it, can Grills be like darting in and out of it trying to get the snoods? Because he knows that those two were like... fucking competition about it. And one of them seems to be very otherwise occupied, so...
Alright, so you're ducking in and out trying to get the snoods, okay.
Trying to get the snoods, partly for all the competition, right. And partly because if these fuckers fall down, they can't be vortexing anymore.
Yes, exactly. Good thinking. Okay, let me see. I don't know if I need to... Well, I mean, you made a 19, so you should be able to be ducking in and out pretty well, and I'm trying to figure out if there's something I need to roll for, like, being able to grab the snoods while you're doing that.
Normally that would be, like, sleight of hand, if you're just trying to grab stuff off, yeah?
Yeah, I think so, yeah. So, yeah, okay. Alright, so you're successfully ducking in and out, so see what you can grab, I guess.
Oh, that's not bad.
And I'm going to roll to see how many of them that you managed to get.
Cool. That's actually pretty good. All right, that's an 18.
Okay. All right. Well, you managed to spectacularly get one snood off of one of the biggest ones. You get the biggest snood off of one of them, which it immediately goes, boo! And it goes, and it starts veering off. I'm going to see if it, like, crashes into anything else.
Charlie has noticed your snood thievery and is like, oi, come on.
Alright, so my bird rolled a 17, I guess, so I guess that means that he was able to not crash into him, I guess.
Cool.
Alright, the poor thing just goes boo, he falls out of line and he just like bumps up against the side of the house and just falls down beside the house, and it's like, flopping up and down. So,
yeah.
They get the snoot. The
vortex, right?
Jules is just going to be ducking in and out of the vortex, doing grabbing snoods until the vortex collapses in on itself, basically.
Because I was going to say, the 22 was Charlie's perception check to see what Grills was doing.
Yeah. Grills is absolutely not hiding this. yeah. And if someone does call him out, he is just going to say, I'm going to split these. We need to collapse the vortex first.
Charlie, what are you doing? What are you doing while these two are doing this?
Well, any I was about to call them snoods. Any goofus birds that come when their snoods get detached and they fall out of line, any that like come out of the vortex, Abigail's just, I think, going to try and do an animal handling to, calm them down, do a shush.
All right. Okay. So
she's a bird. Bird to bird communication.
All right. You have calm emotions, don't right. you?
So I think what we're going to do is, Charlie, if you want to try to see if you can snatch a snood, or first, I think you're going to need to roll to see if you can get through the vortex.
Yeah, I was going to say, because does he have to get through the vortex? Because he's still riding one of these things. Because I was going to say was, he's just going to become part one with the vortex and then just start snatching snoods left and right.
He's just
going to
blend right in. Nice.
Gently.
Charlie.
Yeah, let me do a sleight of hand to see how I do as I'm riding about. That's a crit fail. I'm burning a luck point on this because what the fuck else am I using them for?
How many more of those luck points do you have?
I get 3 per day.
Awesome.
This is a 12.
Well, it's not.
Well, it's not a crit fail.
It's not. Okay, with a 12, I will say that you're kind of like, sort of like riding along on the outside of it, sort of weaving in and out.
Yeah.
You know, but not quite in the vortex.
It's
I guess,
a really
like,
bumpy ride. He doesn't have the best aim.
Yes, exactly.
Hey, gently.
Huh? Yeah.
Would I don't know how big this vortex is, but for a 20-foot radius sphere, charisma saving throw for the goofuses.
Oh, no. Did they have charisma? I don't know. <Let's see.
laughs> Okay, hang on. Their charisma is 6 with a -2.
Fantastic.
So I'm gonna roll for charisma, I guess. Let's see here. For charisma save. Alright, that's a 13 minus 2 is 11. They have rolled 11.
Excellent. They fail. They fail the DC. All of this chaos is happening. Girls is running in and out. Charlie's getting on this. And Abigail just raises both her wings and is like, alright, everybody settle down. And she's casting Calm Emotions.
Oh, nice. Oh, smart, Abigail.
Yeah.
All right. So, excellent. All right. So, that slowly, they've started, like, you hear a couple of them go, boop, 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 and they start, some of them start slowing down a little bit. They're, like, down at a gentle trot now, and they're kind of, like, calming down, and, you know, they're gradually, you know, they're breaking out of the vortex. There's still a few of them that are, like, running around in circles, but they're gradually slowing down, too. So, I think you did it there, Abigail. So,
excellent.
As long as you don't panic them again.
Bird-to-bird communication. She just dusts herself off.
That's right. Nice work, Abigail. Nice work. All right. Okay, so the vortex is gradually breaking up. And pretty soon, it's the birds are just kind of like milling around right now, you know, looking with their wall eyes everywhere, looking slightly confused.
Grills is going around grabbing snoods.
All right, Grills, you want to go grab some snoods?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
If they're still, it should be just pretty much just walk up and pluck it off, right?
Yeah, exactly. All right, so let's see.
How many fucking birds are there on this map? Hold on.
There was 16.
4, 5, 6. Okay, yeah. So 15 snoods in total, not including the one that Lee is stood on.
Oh, like I did manage to grab a couple when I was in the fucking vortex as well, but not as many.
Okay. All right. I'll say 13 then.
You have grabbed I'm gonna roll to see how many of you guys managed to grab. But you
will not have grabbed any while they were running around. She knows her dex is bad.
Yes, exactly. So this is for Charlie and this is for Grills. Grills, you have managed to grab 8. Nice. Let's see how many Charlie's managed to grab. All right. Charlie has managed to grab 5.
I'll say good.
All right. So now you have pretty much got, let's see, 5, 6, 7, 8.
So there's 3 left.
Thank you. My math is worse. So we have like 3, I guess like 3 left that are still kind of like upright, because as soon as you grab the snoods, the rest of them are just like,
wait, that's 2 plus the one that's Charlie is still technically riding, because when things come, he's like, whoa, Shazza.
Abigail's gonna run and grab any that are left.
You get 3 then, Abigail.
Energy.
So anyway, they the birds have like sort of like all, most of them have collapsed on the ground by now, and they're just kind of like doing the you know, the Three Stooges, the curly shuffle thing, you know, where he's like moving around, you know, they're pretty much doing that. They completely lost their sense of balance.
Sorry, I'm just imagining Abigail coming over to the one that Charlie is riding, plucking the snood off, and it just collapsing underneath him.
Yes.
Yes. Excellent.
Right?
All right. Excellent. Well, you have calmed the vortex. So now what are you guys going to do? Are you going to explore around a little bit more? Are you going to go in the house? What are you going to do?
Considering, I was curious about this house personally.
Also, considering the fucking air horn that went off earlier and then all the ruckus that the goofus birds were causing.
This place is trapped.
Has there been any movement or lights or anything from the house?
No, actually there hasn't. The house is quiet and dark.
Suspicious.
Krills is gonna like hold out a hand for Abigail to wait, and then very carefully go up to the door and use his quarterstaff to poke it open.
Okay. You're going up to the front door on the porch?
Yeah.
Okay.
Keep an eye out for tripwires or some such.
Yeah. Alright, I need you to roll a perception, actually.
Average again. 16.
All right. Very nice. Okay. You happen to see that there is, there does appear to be something, some sort of a tripwire across, the front of the door there, but it's not really obvious where it's leading or what its purpose is.
Okay. Does it look like if the door is open, it'll trigger?
I would say with that 16, yes, it does.
Okay. Lee, you're good with your hands. Can you, disable this?
Yeah, can I have a go? And I do actually have thieves' tools, so I can...
Point it out, move out of the way.
You can use those to disarm traps and everything.
Yeah. All
right, excellent, excellent.
That's why... Why he's asking you?
Yeah. That is right. A expertise is plus 6. So that's a 22.
Is that including is that just your proficiency modifier, or are you adding your dex to that?
That's just my proficiency, so if I was adding my dex, then that would actually boost it up to a 26.
All right. Oh, excellent, excellent. Okay, so anyway, you triggered the trap, Charlie, and of course you guys were out with the 22. You know, you triggered successfully, so you managed to get out of the way just as a net comes flump and falls down, but completely misses you guys because you disarmed it. So it was just apparently a very crudely set up sort of net over the door there.
So starting to get the feeling that people don't really want us poking around here.
Mm-hmm.
Which means there's something to see.
That means there's something to find out. Alright, so you guys gonna go ahead and go inside?
It would likely be wise to clear the area first. Yeah.
Yeah.
Girl's gonna poke open the door. Wait, see if that triggers anything first, and then step in.
Alright. So that's what Grills is doing. The door swings open. Creak. It is dark inside the house, but can somebody roll me a perception right quick? Or Grills, I'll have you roll perception since you're the one going.
I am the only person who can see. That's a natural 20.
That was nice. Okay.
Oh, not 120.
You hear the sound of feathers rustling and a low.
There's another one.
There's actually the sound too. Separate. You hear the boo, 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 and then you hear another one go boo, boo, boo.
There's two more.
Yeah.
Can you see where they are with that 26?
Let's see. He's got the dark.
He's got dark vision. And he's got the perceptive feet. So being in a lightly obscured area doesn't pose advantage. If you can see here.
Alrighty. Okay. So I am going to put up another map here. Hang on just a second here.
Oh ho.
Yeah, I know.
Map.
Yep. Another one of my highly advanced maps. Let's see here. Give me just a second, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Is that
right? Yeah, meanwhile, like, Charlie just leaning, like, Leo leaning over to Abigail and I was like, how much do you want to bet his mom's living here?
100%.
You want to make a bet?
Me as a player wants in on this, but I know that girls wouldn't.
Bet you a couple snoods.
Nice.
Well, I reckon she's here, and if you reckon she's here, then yeah, so I don't think either of us can really win this one, can we?
Okay. Yep. And let's see. I will also say that with the 26 that you did, you also hear from upstairs, you hear a very faint boo, boo. You hear three more boo. So currently you are in the kitchen.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah. Oh, hang on a second. I forgot one. There you go. All right. So, and there again. You guys are inside the kitchen right now, and this is, you are on the bottom floor. This is pretty much what you're seeing. You are seeing stairs, you're seeing the kitchen, the potbelly stove, and you see cabinets overhead. Underneath the stairs, there is a door. And you see Goofus Bird over by in the door, and you see another Goofus Bird on the table.
Can we just walk past them?
I mean, Girls is attempting to.
Sure, why not? It's
not a great roll. 13.
All right.
Very slowly moving through the building.
Okay.
Kind of drawing attention.
All right. They are apparently watching you pretty carefully. Like, you almost get the feeling that they're sort of like guarding the place. But whether or not they choose to attack, that's another thing entirely. Maybe, you know, as long as you guys maybe don't make any sudden moves. So
it's just be suspicious.
Don't be suspicious.
All right. So which direction are you heading now? Or which one are you trying to sneak past? Are you trying to sneak past the one sitting on the kitchen table, or are you trying to sneak past the one by the door?
I think Grills would head for the stairs. I don't know about the other two. But...
Okay. All right. So Grills is heading for the stairs upstairs. Gotcha.
Yeah. Like, Lee's going to follow.
All right. So Lee's going to follow. And what about Abigail?
And now I sit here debating, do we split the party?
Do you
think about it?
We're still surrounded by these things.
Yeah, yeah. She thinks about it, but no.
It's like that scene, I don't know if you've ever seen Alfred Hitchcock's The Birds, whenever they're like the last little bit where they're like going through and there's like these whole flocks of birds.
Yeah.
They're just sitting there like,
ooh. Yeah, she's sticking with.
It's very unnerving. So you guys are heading upstairs?
Yeah.
Yep. Marching order Abigail last, because she's like, all right, I'm letting the monk and the rogue go first.
All right, okay. So you get upstairs. There are two doors here. You can try either one of them, but they are both locked. So if you want to, you can unlock them and look inside, see what's there.
Girls is going to gesture for the rogue to step forward.
Yeah, I think Lee like definitely goes forward, like gives a little nod, but like little thank you sort of thing, and then just like has like looks at the lock for 2 seconds and then just on the door instead.
Oh. That is when, now, which one did you knock on? Which door did you knock on? The small room or the larger room?
Grills, where were we?
we're at the top of the stairs at the moment, so it'd be the door closest to the top of the stairs.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think it's the larger room.
Okay. All right. So you hear a very loud and angry sounding.
Oh, well, now you've torn it.
Yeah.
Is that from behind? behind, no, was that from the large door, like right behind, or from behind the door that's still closed and locked?
It's actually, it's the one that, in the big room, it's like coming from like inside of it.
Okay.
Oh, so you're casting knock?
No, no, I wasn't casting anything. This is Charlie just knocking on the door to see what response there would be.
Mm-hmm. And you hear a very angry, and some moving around, some shuffling, some feathers flapping, whatever's in there. It's, well, we know it's a goofus bird, duh. But the goofus bird in there does not sound very happy. That one in there sounds more likely to, like, want to, like, jump you guys.
Yeah, so I think, like, Lee's just gonna, like, do you still want in there?
Let's leave that room for last.
Okay.
Okay.
Same thing on the other door.
All right, so we're gonna go knock on the other door.
Yep.
All right. So, you knock on the other door, and you again hear... And you hear a responding... They appear to be communicating.
None of us have speak with animals. Why?
But you know, they're talking. They don't sound particularly hostile. They just sound like they're just like discussing something. Okay. Clearly, they're discussing philosophy.
You know? Yep. Okay. Is that door still locked as well, or?
Yes, both the doors of the two rooms upstairs are both locked. So.
Okay, I reckon Charles is going to have a go at lockpicking on the one where they seem mildly less hostile. That's a 21.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
Nice.
Very nice. Well, that's enough to open it. And you will see that, you know, there's no trap or anything like that in there. When you open the door, you see a goofus bird that is over by the... he's like sitting on the bed looking at the door, like whenever you first open up the door, he's like right there looking at you. And the other, you hear another overhead, and you see that the goofus bird, the other goofus bird, has somehow managed to perch itself above the door, so it's just kind of like looking down at you, and they're both like eyeing you, like you get the feeling that they're like eyeing you. Well, I mean, it's hard to tell because their eyes are in two different directions, but they definitely turn their heads so that they can get a better look at you, and you get the feeling they're just kind of like studying you to see what you're going to do. For the room itself, somebody want to roll a perceptive to see what else you see in the room?
God, Abigail, please.
Unless you guys have some way of seeing in the dark, you're rolling at disadvantage, y'all.
Oh, well, yeah. Fine. I won't have that 21 then, I guess.
All right.
That's a 16 instead.
All right.
Well, it can't get worse than a 6, and then it was a 4.
Oh, boy. That's a crit fail.
Abigail, like, bumps into something.
Oh, no.
She might bump into a goofus bird.
Well... Yeah.
Walks right
okay, into so anyway, what you guys are looking at, you Grills and you Charles, excuse me, Lee, you Lee, are looking at what appears to be a child's bedroom. There is, it's not, you know, clearly, you know, and you got this impression when you first came in the house. Clearly, this place has not been lived in for a long, 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 long time. I mean, there's dust and cobwebs all over the place. You know, the bed, you know, is, you know, the bed is like in disarray because one of the goofus birds decided to make it its nest. But the bed is small enough that it apparently, you know, had a child in it at one time or another. And there is a line of books, what looks like books overhead over the bed. And not really much else, just the goofus birds kind of eyeballing you guys and just being sort of wary and looking at you.
So what's in there?
A bed where one of
the goofus... Sorry, that was Abigail in character because she can't fucking see.
Okay, never mind.
Nothing much, if I'm honest.
Mm-hmm. Yep, there's well, just boring. A little... There's a little stack, there's a little shelf of books.
What
bed
books are there? What does a 16 get me in terms of what's on the bookshelf?
What gets on bookshelf? You actually would have to move a little bit closer to the bed in order to see.
Right. You already said before there weren't any more traps, yeah?
Yeah.
I did. All right. Yeah, Lee will take a couple of steps in to have a look at the bookshelf then.
All right. All right. As soon as you step in, you step a little closer to the bed. One on the bed, the goofus bird on the bed, fluffs its feathers out and it immediately like pecks at you.
Roll
I don't know if I need to say roll initiative or whatever, because I mean, it's just like it says it has a melee weapon attack, +5 to hit, reach 5 feet, one target, hit is 8d8 +4 piercing damage.
Yeah, roll to attack then. So that would be d20 plus that 5.
Yeah, all right. So I'm going to roll, I guess, to see if he hits or not. All right. I have rolled a 6 for the bird to try to peck at. Who was it? Charlie that, or Lee that was? Okay. So
yeah.
Lee was trying to get closer to see the books. And the bird like kind of like pecks at him. So I rolled a 6.
Yeah, I think like Charlie just like Lee just looks at this and was like, wait, no, back down, no, sort of thing, just putting a hand at it and doesn't do anything.
It's buffing itself up. It's gonna try to intimidate Charlie. Let's see if it works. Because these creatures are so very intimidating.
Oh yes, incredibly so.
Incredibly intimidating. Oh, all right, let's see what they roll. Okay, let's see. 15. Rolled a 15.
I do a wisdom save against that, don't I?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Okay.
Wisdom save or insight check, I think.
Let's go insight. I have slightly larger thing there, so that's an 18, so.
You're not
nice.
I was like back down. It's okay. Yeah. It's kind of just getting it to go back.
Its head feathers are just like sticking out right now, and it's apparently like trying to do some kind of little threat display, but it's not. It doesn't seem like it's too keen on you wanting to look at the books.
Charlie just turns back over to Abigail and just go like, "Oi, don't suppose you can do that fancy spell again, can you?"
Rose is sneaking by to look at books.
Yeah, well, Charlie's got the bed. Yeah.
I mean, yeah, I got a couple more of those in me.
We'll see if Grills thinks it's necessary.
Yeah.
Does Grills manage to successfully sneak?
I don't know. Let's see.
Does he sneak 100 this time?
Didn't they have a passive perception of like 15, wasn't it? So
I think it was 14.
14, yeah.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, passive perception's 14.
Yeah, so
I rolled an 8.
He successfully sneaks 100 this. All right, cool.
Okay, all right.
What does he see? What are the books?
The goofus bird is like got one of its heads turned and just like eyeballing Kai. I mean, sorry. Yeah.
Suddenly, I appear
Kai
in the game.
Humankind.
Suddenly, you are in the game now.
Shit. How did I get here?
Just out of nowhere, a goofus bird just pops up in your room and eyeballs you.
Oh god. That's terrifying.
Terrifying.
I do not need a 6-foot bird.
Anyway,
in my tiny
the goofus bird is eyeballing Lee and it seems to be too distracted, so Grills has managed to successfully go over there. And the books themselves, they appear to be like a series. The name of the books is something like, you know, the I'll say it's The Boisterous Boy's Guide to Outdoors. You know, it's just one of those like typical little, you know, series, like, you know, that somebody a child might read, you know, talk about like survival skills and, you know, all this other cool stuff. They've apparently been there for a while because the pages are pretty wrinkled and stuff like that. But you know, they're just like, they're rather beautifully covered. You know, you can tell that they're pretty old.
So what you gonna do?
Is there anything that like immediately jumps out, or any like pictures or anything?
If you want to pick one up and look through it.
Just looking on the shelf. He doesn't want to try and move anything yet. Is it just books, or are there any like photos or anything?
No, it just appears to be just a stack of that book series. Just leaning against each other's been there for a while. It's all cobwebby.
He'll like grab the top one. Sneakily. Okay.
Alright. So you can grab the top one. You wanna take a peek?
Flick through, yeah.
Yeah, alright. It looks as though when you flip through the book, it looks as though there's been a lot of like whoever owned this book before either has like real bad handwriting or they're a child. There is a lot of like notes and stuff like that, badly spelled notes and that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. And towards the back of it, there is something scribbled, and it appears to say property of, and you can't quite make out the rest of it.
Curls is starting to squint suspiciously, but he'll put it back, try and grab another one, figure out who the fuck this belonged to, get a name.
Mm-hmm.
If he quickly flicks through each of the books, will he get a name or no?
It seems to be that only that book was the one that said property of something or other.
Okay.
The rest of them have more notations and handwriting and stuff like that, but it's just that one that apparently has a little property of da 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 on it.
All right.
Okay.
He'll sneak back out.
Find anything?
Well, not that I could read.
One of the books you can't read?
I can read.
One Are you sure? Hadn't... You don't sound sure.
I'm a real kind, I'm sure.
Well, don't discriminate against real kind. I'm sure there's real kind that can't read.
Anyway, one of the books did have a name in it, but the child's handwriting was too messy. I couldn't make it out.
Right,
Since you guys have moved away from the books too, I will say that both of the birds seem to be settling down. They're just really strangely protective of this room for some reason or another.
I'm starting to wonder why the ranger brought us here, of all places.
I mean, the look when we first rolled up seemed important.
Angry and nostalgic.
Gently just making the bird noises in the background is killing me. I'm sorry.
Background noises are always top tier.
Just dying.
Do you think we could go into the other room, or should we look downstairs first?
I mean, Blackley suggested I've still got, like, two slots left that could be used to fire off calm emotions. So if they're real bad tempered, I can just try to, you know, cozy them down.
I reckon it's worth a shot.
Yep. Alright, so you guys gonna head out?
Yep, we're gonna
try the next room?
Yep, unlocking
the mm-hmm. Alright.
Angry Bird Room.
Saving throw for the birds in the angry room.
Yes. The angry room. The angry room.
24 right. On lockpicking.
Okay, very nice. That's more than enough to get you through. So you open up this door, and again, there is this atmosphere of, you know, neglect. Nobody has lived here for a bit. And what you see is there's very, you want to roll a perception, I guess, and I can tell you what to see.
Oh, hell yeah. Yep.
All right, very nice. Okay.
25.
All right. So, basically what you
got is...
Oh, wait. I forgot I'm at disadvantage because of fucking...
She's, like, holding on to one of you to walk places.
Oh. 7, 4, and 25.
God.
More than that one.
Why couldn't I stick with that 22? It's because it's dark, I know, but come on.
Are we just in a train, like... Lee's holding on to Chris.
Okay, well, anyway, with the perception, what you guys see is you see another room apparently has not been used for a while. It is papered in, you know, very pretty wallpaper, but has unfortunately been become rather faded over time. It's not very sparse. You kind of get the feeling that whoever lived in this house probably didn't have that much money to begin with, because it just has kind of like that. It's very sparse and Spartan with its decorations and that sort of thing. There is a bed over in the corner. Beside the bed, there is a nightstand, and on the bed there is a rather large goofus bird that does not look happy at all, and immediately hops up and goes, "Whoa!"
Girls are stepping in front of the other two.
Make a charisma save. See if Abigail calms it down.
Alrighty.
I do think
hears this and goes, "Oh hell no!"
11
fails.
Yep, that's right. Okay,
the bird is calmed. Abigail just like makes like, "Okay, come on now, shush, shush." Yep, that's right. We're not here to do anything. We're just, you know, being nosy. Ain't nothing wrong with being nosy.
It seems to be grumbling, but it is calmed down. It gets up. You see it gets up off the bed, and as you do that, you can see actually it seems to be favoring one of its feet. Like, you know, it's like limping a little bit, but it just like kind of limps over in front of the nightstand and plops down in front of it and just like looks at you guys. And I think it's pretty obvious what the message is here. It's like, you're not going to go any further than this.
Can Charlie kind of like very gently go towards it, hands out, doing the heart calming gesture, and go, "Shh, all right, it's all right, it's all right. We got this. You're all right?" And just kind of, and cast, which one is it? Like, cure wounds on it? Because if it's limping, then it's injured. And
yeah,
you can see that. Make it less injured, please.
Yeah, sure. All right.
Promise we're not here to hurt you.
It scoots back a little bit towards the nightstand in the bed. It obviously is not comfortable with you guys coming towards it.
Okay, that's fair.
Mm-hmm. And it's just sort of Hold on.
Abigail can't see. She's like, "I won't let it touch you. I can just use healing word." A creature of your choice that you can see. Nope. Yeah,
that's the problem.
Oh no.
All right, question. Can Charlie get just close enough that if I do sleight of hand real quick, I can boop it on its fucking beak to do cure wounds? Like, I will still be as far away as possible, but just enough that I can dart in really quick for it.
Sure, you can do that.
That's a 29. I boop the goofus.
The goofus bird draws back and it's like, you know, it turns its head like it seems like it's trying to see you guys better, and it looks like vaguely insulted about that. It's still not moving away from in front of the bed and the nightstand there.
Yeah, well, I had a shot at it.
Rose is taking a look around. Try and see if he can spot any clues.
Mm-hmm.
Any pictures or anything? Any more books?
No, there doesn't appear to be anything, really. It's just, you know, just the nightstand and the bed. The window.
Look around at the nightstand. Not move much closer, but like...
If you can sort of get the goofus bird out of the way, because right now it seems it's a very deliberately trying to block your way to the nightstand and the bed.
Oh, you know what? We had a try going at doing this a nice way. And I try and steal the snood from the goofers with a 15.
Oh, God.
All right.
That puts me up to steal 6 snoods.
All right. Well,
Charlie does that just as Abigail's like pulling bird seed out. So Charlie's chosen like the semi-violence route.
Again, we tried doing it the nice way. Now we're going to do it the effective way.
I guess we'll see. I guess successfully you snitched the snood, I guess.
Yep. Does this thing flop?
The bird. He's not happy. He goes, boo! Falls down and he's just like falling in front of it. But he just looks absolutely indignant. He's just like flopping around and stuff, but yeah, you have managed to get him out of the way. So yes, you want to take a look at
right.
The
all right, Grills is vaulting over to look at that nightstand.
Lee just like looking down at the bird, going Gross. Like, "Oh, we tried. You had a turn at doing it the nice way. This is your fault."
You can notice birdseed at the direction of the angry sounds
with the foot that apparently was hurt. It looks as though somebody has tried to bandage it up.
Ooh.
Mm-hmm. And quite recently, actually.
Ooh. Now, I will say, I probably didn't notice that because I only got a 7 for my perception, so.
Mm-hmm. Well, whoever was it, rolled good perception.
Are there any...
throwing the seed, half of it is hitting Charlie.
Are there any, like, signs of who this house belongs to?
Are you looking in the nightstand?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Roll perceptive, see what you find.
Oh, boy. Okay. That's average. Still 16.
Okay. Yeah, that's more than enough. You actually find what appears to be a little gold locket in there.
He feels bad as he picks it up, but he will pop it open.
Alright. And you see a picture. There are two pictures in there. They're very faded, but one appears to be that of a little boy with squinty eyes. And on the other side of it, there is a picture of a woman, also with squinty eyes, and it's pretty obvious you can tell that these two are related.
Does this boy look like a certain ranger if he were a kid?
Gosh, am I that obvious?
We're toons, we know how stories work.
Yeah, we know how stories work. Well, yes, you would say, I mean, the little boy has like a little, he has a little pop gun, and he is wearing a little stripy suit and overalls, and he looks very cute, and his eyes are squinty, but yes, there does seem to be some familial resemblance there.
He'll pocket the locket. That's so fun to say. Oh my god. He'll pocket the locket and then move back out the way. And like gesture with his head for the lift to come out of the room.
Mm-hmm. Abigail cannot see the gesture. She's still throwing bird seed.
Yeah, okay. Lee just kind of grabs her arm.
The poor bird is sitting there sort of like banging its face up against the floor trying to reach it.
Lee, now covered in bird seed, does just kind of grab her by the arm and steer her back out.
Yeah, hands off the goods. Come on.
All right. So you guys are heading back downstairs now?
Well, Girls is just gonna like gesture for them to come onto the landing above the stairs, and then pop open the locket again, hold it out for the other two to see, and like summon a small flame in his hand so that they can actually see it.
Yep.
Told ya.
There it is.
The other thing is, that leg that was hurt was bandaged recently. I suspect that the mother, wherever she is indeed still alive.
Oh, good. Well, we can solve Ranger's mania about this. Didn't seem like there was a door downstairs.
There is, in fact, a door underneath the stairs.
There was one underneath the stairs.
So, one more place to check? Then, suppose we have to go hunting her down.
Mm-hmm. Alright, well, you guys head on downstairs, and, unfortunately, you see the two goofus birds are standing there directly in front of the door, and they seem pretty intent on not letting you through.
Getting real sick of these birds, though, just gotta say.
Say what?
Grills just, like, looks at Lee and goes, I'll take the one on the left, you get the one on the right?
Yeah.
Then he just fucking reaches forward. That's hell! Yeah, baby! Reaches forward and grabs the snood off the one on the left.
Yeah, and that's a 19 from Lee with the one on the right.
I am now up to 7 snoods.
Nice. Alright, yep, you grab the snoods off of the birds and yeah, they pretty much flop over and there's the door. The door is locked, but it shouldn't be a problem for it.
Yeah.
Open it up.
Yeah, okay. But I was like, I think like as Lee's doing this, like, these birds really make the most useless guards though, gotta say.
Once you know the trick, yeah. Goodness.
Alright. You pop open the door. And it appears to be a pantry.
How much? Or okay. Is there any food there that doesn't look off?
There is, in fact, on the shelves, there appears to be a lot of food that looks like it is recent. Doesn't look like it's dusty. Like this pantry has been used recently. That's true.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody else want to roll some perception?
Roll perception, because why the hell would you lock a pantry? There's got to be something else in here.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. For nice. Like a false wall or
a goal.
Oh,
how many is that? That's like 5.
Oh, baby, we lost you.
God, you are just cursed. Okay, that's a 10 from Lee.
This is making up for the Henrik fights last night or the night before, whatever the hell that was.
God, it really is. It is feast right, and famine with me and Dice Parser.
All right, so you rolled, let's see, Grills rolled a 20, Abigail rolled a 4, and you have 2 rolls there? 10 and 18? Yeah,
it's because I'm at disadvantage because it's night, so go with the 10.
Okay, I got you. Okay, all right. Okay, so I would say Grills is probably the first one to see it, but you can see that there are quite a few, there's like a 2 or 3 barrels that are up against the wall there. It looks like they're little ale barrels, you know, type of thing. You know what I'm talking about. Like they're on their side, you know.
Actual got little barrels or like small kegs?
Oh, well, small kegs, I should say. But I mean, okay. Like probably roughly, you know, big enough, you know, that you could like, I'm trying to think of what would be an average. There's 2 or 3 kegs up against the wall. You notice that 2 of them, and they're like flat up against the wall underneath the shelf of like cans and stuff. You notice that 2 of them look, are very dusty and cobwebby and look very, like very, you know, like they haven't been bothered for a while. The 3rd one is actually not. It's quite clean.
Okay.
I'm still just like blind as a bat.
Everyone has a passive perception above 9, yeah?
Yes.
You can hear Gruul's murmuring under his breath, please be a secret tunnel, please be a secret tunnel, as he reaches forward to move the keg out the way.
If it is a secret all right, tunnel.
So he does move the keg out of the way. Doesn't budge.
Oh.
Nope.
Like Lee just like pats him on the back for that. You had a go at it. Can I use thieves' tools to kind of poke at it and see if there's any traps or mechanisms attached?
You can do that. Go ahead and poke around there, Lee.
That's a dirty 20.
Nice. All right. I think that's enough. Well, anyway, Lee, while you're kind of there knocking and plundering around, you happen to hit the spigot, which goes, actually turns over, and the front of the barrel opens up. And there is indeed a passage there with stairs leading down.
Is it quiet?
Yes.
In the background.
It is very quiet.
All right. I do think this is like, I think this one point where like he does just take a step back. Right. Well, I'd say ladies first, but I reckon if this one went first, then it'd be head first down the stairs. So.
Now. Yeah. The barrel was just barely big enough for you guys to get through. Like, you got to kind of, like, you know, get down on your hands and knees, crawl in there, and then, you know,
get, if it's yeah, heads and knees for Charlie, it's gonna be like on his stomach for Grills. But this man was a soldier. He can crawl. That's
he can fine. Do it. He can do it.
Yeah. So he like gestures for the two to step back a bit to give himself some room, and then goes on his front, starts commander crawling through.
Excellent. Yeah.
Pauses for a moment, snaps his fingers and like starts crawling one arm to hold the flame up so that you can see what the fuck they're doing.
All right, yeah. Lee's gonna follow and hopefully Abigail behind him. I think grab onto my tail just so you won't get lost.
Alrighty.
There's like this mock offended sniff, but she does in fact do that.
Like, I just, like, actually, can I get a quick insight check from you, Abigail?
Yeah, absolutely. Abigail, I swear for the love of God, please.
Please.
Nice person, please.
Okay.
Average.
All right. Average. An average with a 13, it's just high enough that you do notice a tiny bit of hesitation from Lee before he says that. So this is not something that he would just tell to someone, like, people casually.
All right, well, she can only sort of guess what that's about, but, like, the grip is going to be just, you know, gentle, not crushing, whatever. It's just, you know,
yeah,
hand on the tail to keep track of things.
Yeah, no, that's fair.
All righty. Okay, so you guys are going down, down, down. All right. You go down there. It is obviously that this is some kind of cellar that you're going into. It is very, very dark. You can't really see anything, except for, of course, for you guys that are, have the, dark sight.
Produce flame. Let me just double check the radius on it, but...
I mean, you're doing produce flame, but also you're directly in front of everyone, and the biggest one, you might be blocking sight.
Produce flame sheds light in a 10-foot radius, and then dim light in another 10 feet beyond that.
Okay, so, mm-hmm. Like, we see a little bit, but not much.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. And as the light flares into existence there, this is going to be what you see here. Hang on a second. Let me pull him up here.
Mother snood.
It has a hat.
My God. It has a fez.
It has a fez. And the light, and it blinks a little bit. First of all, you will notice that this bird's eyes are facing forward. It looks very, very angry, and it doesn't look too pleased to see you guys come creeping down here. Strangely, it does not make a blue noise. It just stares at you guys for a second. And then it's just gonna attack. So you guys go ahead and roll for initiative. So
okay, it's a good thing Grills is in the front then, huh?
Yep.
Might just 12. Oh. Okay.
Was it plus 4?
Gotta say the detail that the eyes are forward facing is.
That's
yeah,
the terrifying.
The sudden snap to predator. Oh, nice, there we go.
That's Lee with an 18.
Okay, so Lee's
broken
going
the
first.
Curse of ones.
Is Abigail one L or two? I think I spelled it wrong the first time.
All right, and I'm gonna roll initiative. See what my buddy is here. All right, I rolled an 18 for our.
What's the modifier?
The modifier, blah, 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 blah. Initiative modifier. I don't think. Let's see here.
It's Dex if it's not on the sheet.
Oh. It's a plus 2 with the Dex. So 18, 19, 20.
Okay,
so
all right.
All right. So let's see
what so Grills is going first, all right.
Okay.
Predator goof.
Lord Goof is Predator Goof. Oh, that's terrifying.
I mean,
like, yeah, you're right, but I still don't like it.
I can't believe that even with rolling an 18, Abigail still ended up last in the initiative because we all just got 18. And our deck is 1.
Look, we're deck. It's a deck-based team. This is just what happens.
Yeah. Gods. Well, Grills is going first. If this thing is gonna attack, Grills is gonna fucking throw himself at it. So mm-hmm. it doesn't attack the other two.
Oh.
So I don't think he even has time to pull out his quarterstaff. But bonus action to light the fuck on fire so everyone can see. Ugh. Okay, that's not great. First attack. Oh, that's worse. Second attack. I'm kind of hoping the fact that he's on fire will startle it.
Roll intimidation.
We're gonna spend a key point. Oh, I can't spend a key point. I've already used my bonus action. Never mind. Carry on.
No, I was gonna say roll intimidation, maybe.
Roll intimidation. Oh, now I get a good roll. God. No, not 4. 14 plus 4.
So 18.
18.
All right. So you got 18. All right.
18 intimidation.
Oh, nice, nice. Okay. Let's see. What is my buddy's intimidation? It actually has like a little bit of a higher charisma. I think about like 12.
This is, you're not rolling contesting intimidation. You're rolling contesting insight or wisdom save, whichever is better.
Oh, contesting insight. All right. Let's see here. Okay.
Insight is just roll a what?
A 20.
Like dirty or natural?
A natural 20.
Oh boy.
Fuck me. All right. What's his wisdom modifier? What's his wisdom modifier?
His wisdom modifier. Let's see. It is.
Do these birds have any wisdom? Like, we know they're in the negative. No,
I don't think it looks. It doesn't look like it's got a wisdom modifier.
Okay, so it's just 20 then. Yeah. All right. Well, it still beats an 18.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not afraid.
Nope, it's definitely not afraid.
And it's going next. Girls is right in its face, though, so if it wants to try and attack the other two, he's going to attack it and opportunity.
All right. There. Okay. All right, let me get this filler up, going up here. Sorry, the computer went down on me for a second. Okay. All right, so he is going easy. He can make two attacks. He can make an attack with his beak and attack with his claws. Mm-hmm. So he's going to roll first to attack. I think that's a 20 you roll for? With
Yeah, d20 plus the attack modifier, which will be okay. on the thing next to each okay. attack.
So he's got a plus 5 to hit. His hit is for the beak is 10, and that's 1d8 plus 4 piercing damage.
10 does not hit.
Okay, hang on a second. I haven't rolled it yet. Hang on.
Oh.
All right. Okay, 3, 4, 8. So, yeah.
Does not hit.
Okay.
So, next right. attack.
Next is the claws. They have 12 for the claws.
Yeah, that's how much damage it'll do, probably.
All right. Okay. All right. Come on, baby. Alright. 12.
Does not hit.
Okay. Alright. So the little but he's whinnying.
They just can hit each other.
Out there and he like hits with his beak and lashes out with his claws. But that is a miss for
for Grills. You lucked out there, buddy, but you still have a very angry, very large creature. He's considerably larger than the other Goofus birds. He's like maybe about how tall was Grills again?
Grills is 6'10".
6'10". This guy's probably about 7 foot.
Okay.
So he's a little bit taller than Grills.
All right. Next up is Lee, who's kind of looking at this thing and going like, well, guess we don't have much of a choice here. And he is going to pull out Flame Blade because he loves that spell.
Nice.
So he is going to be, yeah, casting time, bonus action. This does mean, sadly, he cannot give Bardic Inspiration to Grills, but he is going to instead make a fucking attack against the thing by stepping forward. Does a 19 hit?
Oh, nice. Lord have mercy.
Yeah.
Yep. Alrighty. All right. 3d6 fire damage. Please take 11 fire damage as Lee just slashes down with this thing and go like, alright, well, we're going at this thing then.
Good bird. Oh no. Alright, so that was 11 he took down?
Yep.
Okay, alright. And let me see what this fella's...
Also, we have extra light now as well, because it also shed light.
Alright, let's see here. Okay, I got it. It's still standing. It's pretty tough with the hit points, but you definitely dealt it a blow there. So, and I guess like I don't know, like I roll for damage or
I've already rolled damage, so you take 11 off the hit points of
the bird. Okay, I got you. Brain no working so good. Okay.
Bird turn.
Barbecue time.
Turn of the bird. Abigail's casting spiritual weapon.
Hell yeah.
Wahoo.
We are just going at this thing.
Mm-hmm.
We've decided on violence.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it tried to violence us, so we violenced it.
It started it.
Yeah.
Yep. And so the spiritual weapon that comes into being is basically, it just looks like a giant eraser.
Ah!
Amazing. Oh boy.
Yep. Oh boy. So
let's see if we can hit this bird.
All right. Get that bird.
Yeah.
Get it. Get it.
Nice.
Wahoo. All right.
Wahoo.
So that's going to be, it's a d8 plus spell casting modifier, so.
Mm-hmm.
8 plus 6.
Mm-hmm.
14 damage. This eraser just like appears into existence over the bird and just goes.
Nice.
Like it's trying to erase it.
God.
Oh my gracious. Okay. All right. Well, you've knocked it down another notch there. It's staggering a little. It's not down yet, but you two guys have definitely gotten a good knock in there for it. So I guess it's Grill's turn now.
Yeah, we'll see about that. So that one. God damn it. Oh, that's the other one. Bonus action fire blows, because I need these hits, god damn it. And then finally, oh hell yeah, cool. Let's set up a bunch of, oh, that's what it is. Okay, so 14, 16, and then 21 and 25.
Mm-hmm.
How many of those hit?
Let's see here. So what I'm gonna need to do is roll to see if it dodges it, right?
No. Look at its armor class. What's the armor class?
It's a what now?
What's its armor class?
Oh, its armor class. Its armor class is, hang on a second, let me pull it back up. Armor class is
14, I believe.
Okay, so these all hit.
Nice. All right.
I need more dice. Actually, I'm just gonna do some dice parser. Fuck it. 48 plus.
As much as the click clack rocks are a delight, when you've got to roll that.
This is a lot of dice.
Yeah.
Plus 44 plus 60. 51 points of damage.
Christ.
Astounding.
Monks, baby!
Dang!
Holy shit.
That's how much damage! Oh,
that's how much damage total. He just fucking wails on it.
Wow, okay, alright, well.
Girl said no.
Oh my
Girl
God.
Said absolutely okay. not.
Astounding.
All right. Oh, that thing, oh, it rears back, and you have just, like, dealt it. It is, like, staggering now, and it just goes, like, it, you just wail on it, boom, 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 you know, and it just, like, wobbles its head, its little fez comes off, and it backs up, and it just sits down hard and glares at you, and you've pretty much knocked down its points. So it shouldn't be able to attack, but the dumb thing is trying to anyway.
Goodness.
So I'm going to try to roll one more thing and see if it manages to do any damage before it just goes flop. So,
one determined bird.
Yeah, it is a determined bird. All right. Ah, I lost my dice. Oh. All right, let me try again. All right. Okay, so I have rolled 18.
18 will hit.
Okay, all right. So 18, that's going to be with its beak. It's going to do that, and this actually, I think it's got like a +4 to hit. So that's 18 plus 4. Is that correct?
Yeah, that'll hit.
Okay, all right. Okay,
so
and
roll the dabblage.
All right, gonna roll the dabblage. Let's see here. That's 1d6 plus 2. It's near, whoever's nearest to it. Who's nearest to it right now?
Probably Grills.
That's yeah. gonna be Grill.
Okay, alright. So Grills. Alright, Grills. Let's see here. Blah, blah. Right. Okay. Alright. Blah, blah, blah. I'm looking. Okay, so that is a 10. Okay, so the hit was 10 plus 1d8 plus 4. How do I figure that out?
It would be if it has like number and then d something plus something, then you would just roll the d something plus something. The 10 at the beginning there is kind of, hey, this is what the average amount mm-hmm. of damage would dealt would be if you can't be bothered with dice.
Gotcha. Okay, all right. So I just need to roll 1d8. All right, I'm going to do that with this one. Because it's much easier. Plus 4.
You've got the exclamation mark.
You have to have the exclamation mark.
Poot! Okay.
Smack on average.
Imagine the average damage.
Alright. Smackity. And then it's going to lash out, I guess, with its claws and try to hit that. Let's see if it does that. Oh, that's a 2.
Nope. Unless it has a plus 15.
Nope. I'm afraid it don't. Alright, so it does make one last effort, and it manages to peck at you viciously with its beak, but it lashes out with its claws, and, you know, you pretty much have finished it, but before you can, like, strike the final blow, I guess, all of a sudden you hear a very faint voice from the back, way back in the cellar, going, wait, please don't.
Charlie holds off on his turn then and goes like, oh, look, we didn't want to hurt, we didn't want to fight it. It would try to attack us first.
Well, of course it did. It's a dumb bird. And it is guarding me. Come here. The voice is apparently calling to the bird. You hear somebody get up and in the darkness there, and you get up and they start shuffling very, very slowly towards you.
And as light falls on you, it comes close to the bird. And as it turns out, surprise, surprise, it is a much older woman with squinty eyes and very tall lady. She appears to be leaning a bit, because apparently she just had gotten pretty badly hurt at some point. Looks like some kind of accident or something. But she goes and she leans over on the Fez, Mr. Fez, who is like still puffing and fluffing at you. And she just puts her hand on its head and she's just like, stop. And she puts her hands over its eyes and it just immediately freezes and gets still.
That's funny. Just so yes. Stupid.
There's your dad. They're so stupid. Who are you?
I feel this is a conversation not to have in a cellar.
In short, I think we got hired by what we're pretty sure is your son.
My son? Oh, Ranger. Oh. He's not very bright either.
Yeah, we figured that one out ourselves.
Oh,
let's head back upstairs
I think I shall do that. You'll have to excuse me. I was trying to fix up the windows outside and accidentally fell down and busted my leg. I've been down here.
You need a spot of healing?
If you don't mind, I would appreciate that.
Of course.
I was really thinking that you were probably some of the farmers or somebody coming to take the place away from us. So.
Has anybody else taken any damage?
Yes.
Grill took a little bit.
I'm all good.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right.
Also,
I think of the player characters, Grills is the only one who's taken damage so far.
It's Grills in combat, Abigail in eating shit.
Yeah.
So,
true.
We're just gonna get everyone at once.
Yeah.
Why not mass healing word?
Cool. Hell yeah.
Cool.
How much people heal?
Man, it's so nice having two healers on a team.
Isn't it great?
It's awesome.
Just out of curiosity, does that heal the big bird too?
It can, because mass healing word can get up to 6 creatures of choice.
Yeah.
Alright.
So, the bird, the lady, Grills, and Abigail all get 9 hit points back.
Okay. Alright, well, the bird, as soon as it's healed, it immediately, she has to take her hand off of it for a minute, you know, and as soon as it does, the bird pops up, and he looks straight at Abigail. And you hear Abigail, all right, the rest of you hear a wah, 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 wah. But Abigail, you hear words.
Oh, this one speaks. Oh, no. Sing me the song of your people.
Because I'm assuming that Abigail can understand bird.
Yeah, I will say that.
Yeah, so it is speaking bird to her, and it says, how dare you, come here and try to attack the ladies, and you come in here, you busted it, we're just trying to, it's just so angry it can barely talk, but.
You just hear Abigail go back, quack, 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 squawk,
squawk, squawk.
Bird-to-bird communication.
What did Abigail tell it?
Well, now you hold on here just a minute. We didn't even know she was here. We weren't trying to attack anyone. We were just trying to see what was what, maybe figure out how to stop, this other guy from being a big mini-butt to all you goofus birds. You attacked us first.
How dare you? And did you know that her son is the one that's been trying to wipe out me and my goofish bird brethren?
Yes, we did catch on to that, but here's the thing. He seems to think you all did away with Miss is here, gestures at, you know, Mom Ranger.
No. Mom. Ranger Mom.
We show that she's all right and everything's good.
No, but certainly won't. Because as soon as we go upstairs and she sees that she's fine and everything, he's still not going to back off because he's going to call the farmers in here and he's going to take over the place and chase us away.
And at this point, Mom Ranger, who apparently understands Bird as well, she just kind of like, you know, takes her hand and she pats it. She says, she looks over at the bird, at Mr. Fez, and she's just kind of like, we knew this would be coming sooner or later, darling.
Just in the background, Grills leans over to Lee like, do you understand what we're saying?
Not a clue.
Continued squawking as Abigail says, well, if he does decide to do that, then we're just not going to let him. He just won't.
He looks over at Mom Ranger and he's just like,
I think this is some kind of trap trying to lure us out, so there's probably a whole bunch of farmers and your son up there waiting to take us prisoner and drive us away. We had this land for purse. We have always migrated here for millions and millions of years. Now they're saying that we can't do it.
And he's just sounding very indignant.
Look at me. Abigail, like, jumps up into the air, flapping wings. It's very ungraceful to get height with Predator Goofus. Look me in the eye. Would a fellow bird lie to you?
Oh, let me see if it believes or not.
Does she, like, hop up onto Grill's head to get the height?
Yes!
Okay, well, I rolled a 10.
Is that on fire? Is that a problem?
The fire goes out after a minute, so okay. Probably no longer on fire.
Well, I think I'm imagining, you know.
You can just put it out as well.
Feeling and stuff like that, you know.
Yeah, like Charlie probably would have extinguished
it. It does smell a little tasty in here, so.
Yeah, there was a pleasant campfire smell.
Yes, exactly.
Excellent. Along with, like, charred feathers and shit.
Yes, exactly. All right, well, so he rolled a 10, so I guess I'll say maybe, you know, I'll say he looks to Mom Ranger to see if she, what her decision is, and she stands there and she thinks for a minute. She goes, and she looks at them, and she looks at the bird, and she says, she's like, come on, we're going to go upstairs and see what all this is about. So
I'm the colony back home, and if anyone ever tried to kick us off our beach, you know, I would also be a little mad. So it's just not going to happen.
She said, and Mama Ranger nods, and you guys are all, like, going, you know, back upstairs and out, you know, outside.
Is there an easier way than the army crawl? Is there
Well, yes, there just happens to be another little back door.
Okay, good.
And they will go through with ease. That will take them back outside. And it is morning time right now. Most of the goofus birds are wallowing around on the ground. And I'm going to see if the big bird notices that they seem to be missing their snoots.
Oh dear.
Yeah. All right.
Squirrel's snoots are in a bag in his hammer space.
Yes, there is an 18. He rolls an 18. He looks immediately when he gets out there outside. It's morning time by now, you know, so we can pretty much see everything. So he goes and he looks around and he looks over there. He looks at the birds and then he looks indignantly at the group that's behind him. And all of a sudden he just flares up again and stands in front of Mom Ranger and says,
you see, it's a trap. Look how he's defeated our brethren. They're all wallowing around on the floor. They've done something horrible to them. I knew I couldn't trust them.
And he just was like flapping his wings. He's just very, very angry.
Hey, you see here? It's temporary, right? Abigail, with only a slight hesitation, sigh, is going to reach into her hammer space. Because, like, the Velcro noises, Abigail assumes these things can just be put on.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, She pulls out her force nudes. It's like, temporary measures, Mr. Big Bird. Your herd was in a bit of a panic, and, well, I didn't want to blast him.
He's still grumbling to himself, but, you know, he seems to be accepting it. Charlie will
demonstratively put his snoot back on a bird.
Grills, what are you guys going to do?
Grills has just kind of stood there in confusion.
Yeah, we can't understand this guy. So, like...
Oh, man. Yeah, I'm sure that the other two that they're hearing there is this bird going, just like, it looks like it's angry again. It's going.
Abigail, do you feel like translating?
Yeah, she looks back. She's like, this one ain't happy that we've discombobulated the herd.
Whoa, so they're gonna trample us.
Well, that's what I was telling him, but now that we're making peace.
Charlie will grab his own supply of snoods out of his outer space.
And yeah. Abigail is gonna look at, like, you know, Papa Goofus and just go, now, are you able to keep a handle on these guys once they're back up and running? We're not going to deal with another vortex of panic.
And then he thinks about it for a minute, and then he goes, looks over his brethren, and he makes this really loud noise. And immediately, the ones that have got their snoods back on and stuff, they stand up and they're like, and they all, like, start gathering around Mama Ranger and the big guy. And they're just kind of, like, gathering around. And there's, like, now there's a complete wall of Goofus birds in front of you guys. And they're all looking at you. And Mama Ranger says, she's just like, well, where is my son?
Grills will pass off the snooze to Abigail. And kind of lead him around to where they've tied him up against the fence.
I know Charlie will help stick the snoods back on himself, but he will just be muttering under his breath. He's like, I'm pottery, if you want to put on a peacock, and a peacock, and oranges, and oranges, and snoods, and
Brace, yeah.
Now, that's not fair, you've got less than me.
No, more now. Girls had 10 quickly. And gave them all to Abigail.
Oh, wait, yeah, no, in that case, yeah, Rice is on.
You want to roll, see who's faster.
He's, like, over on the ground, and you can hear him. He's, like, faintly snoring. So, Mom Ranger goes over there, and she's just, like, she stands up there to him, and she just, like, shakes her head and looks at him. And then she turns to the rest of them, and she says, she looks at him. She looks very sad, and she's like, you know, this peace can't last because the farmers will want their lands back, and they'll want to drive. They'll send other people out to drive the birds away. The birds are only doing what the birds have been doing for hundreds and hundreds of years. How in the world are we going to solve this?
What I don't understand is why they haven't adapted what the birds do. If they naturally migrate through the area, they should be accustomed.
Well, I suppose that's true, but, you know,
girls like the retirees.
Yeah. She just kind of, like, looks over Ranger, and she says, most of the farmers have pretty much his mindset, you know, that they're pests and beasts that need to be destroyed.
Girls takes a moment, presses his hands together, and is just like, I mean this in the best way possible. They are dumb as a box of rocks.
Yes, I'm aware of that. She just kind of nods and smiles. She's like, yes, I know. But see, the thing of it is like, and she sits there and she's thinking for a minute. She's just like, I didn't know that, but you see, what happened was whenever he was young, you know, I pretty much had the same mindset as the other farmers, that, you know, that these birds would come through, they would eat up all the crops, they would ruin our crops, they would just wreak havoc over the land and just destroy the livelihood of the farmers. And then and you know, of course, I was thinking the same thing as the farmers were thinking, that they were just dumb pests to be destroyed. And that unfortunate incident, you know, where I attempted to do just that and were set upon by the goofus birds. But I didn't realize that they actually have a sort of, she's just like, she's trying to search for the right words. We don't want to say culture, because they are kind of dumb birds, so I don't know if they would count for getting a culture or not, but you know,
girls roll for the term social hierarchy.
She's like, they were, well, I mean, they're just doing what birds do. And I don't know how to solve this, because on one hand, if the farmers give up their land, then that's them out. You know, they can't support their families. And, you know, on the other hand, if, you know, we drive the birds away, we're hurting the birds, and it's not likely. I mean, this is only a small portion of the birds. I mean, we're talking birds of hundreds and hundreds.
Weird question, but don't suppose you've tried writing to the prince about this, have you?
What? She's
prince is gonna pay attention. You think royalty? You think, like,
yeah.
What part of Einkrell are we even in right now? We're
in
this point. We're in the furthest reaches. I don't know.
Who the fuck knows?
More Australian.
But no, like, Charlie's just bringing this up because, like, he's just thinking that one time that fucking Shorts kid decided to write to Prince Ekim about getting a bunch of land to make something to help people, like land and money to get a place to help people. And it's just like
conservation.
It's worth another shot.
There you go. Yeah. Well, she sits there, she thinks about it for a minute, and she says, I'm not even sure if the prince knows me over here, but I didn't think about it. I don't know how to negotiate a peace between the farmers and the goofus birds. I wanted them best to kind of both live in harmony, but I don't know if that's possible.
Again, why does anyone have to give up their land at home? The birds aren't here the entire year. The farmers can farm around that copy.
That's true, but
Rills raises a point.
Mm-hmm.
That's the next thing is there any free land at all that could be, you know, sectioned off for birds or for the season? It's just for them? Sharing space at all.
She thinks about it for a minute, and she looks over at Ranger, and she looks over at them, and she looks over at the birds, and she says, is there a way that I can make this property, my property, some sort of conservation, thank you, conservation place for these birds in particular? I've got plenty of land. I don't mind them coming, and, you know, would that be possible?
You have the land rights, don't you?
It's your land. You run off anyone who thinks otherwise.
Yeah,
I mean, it sounds like you had to start here with your traps. You just gotta make it official.
I had set those traps because I was afraid that it wouldn't be long before they would raise an army to come down here and just wipe them completely out. Not that it's hard, but I mean,
so long as you have some method that you can keep the birds on your land, and I don't see anyone who could raise an issue.
Let me speak a moment to Mr. Fez here. And she goes and she turns to the Fez bird, and she's talking bird to him. So they sit there and they conversate back and forth for a while, and he doesn't seem like, he's still a little wary, like he's sort of like side eyeing the rest of the group and, you know, looking back at her back and forth, and he's just like, you know, and finally he answers back and he goes, blah, 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 and he just kind of shrugs his bird shoulders. And she turns back and goes,
squawk, squawk.
Squawk, squawk. So she turns around and she says, Mr. Fez would be amiable to that. I think he can communicate with his people and tell them, you know, where it is safe for them to go during the season. So I think we can do something about that. And then the farmers can return back to their land.
All right. This one here, Abigail's going to jerk her thumb back at Ranger. Seems the most gung-ho about things. So if we get him on board, mm-hmm. figuring everyone follows.
Mm-hmm.
Also, did need to fake your death? Because, like, probably would have been better ways to go about that.
Yeah.
Yeah, sometimes you panic.
Yeah. Oh, she said she goes and she just like she sort of shakes her head and she's just like, well, I didn't know. You're right, I didn't know what to do. I was afraid that if I tried to make myself appear again to my son, I hadn't even known what had happened to him up until a few years ago. I was afraid if I tried to get in touch with him again that he would just think I'd gone bird.
Well, that was a valid fear. He did think we'd be in mind control.
Yeah, that is true.
Well, we'll see. And she goes
over
there.
Not about the brains of a bird.
She goes over there and she pokes at Ranger and she's like, Ranger, darling. Ranger, wake up. Wake up. And he's like, what? And then he looks up at her and he goes, am I dead?
Do you want to be? No, that's not canon.
No. Mama, is that you? That's Mama. And she just kind of nods her head. She goes, yes, son, it's me. We've got a lot of catching up to do, but you are the one that has been elected by the farmers to deal with this situation, and I'm afraid we need to have your good word on this, but we've negotiated a treaty of sorts to let the goofus birds stay here, and son, they really are harmless. They can't hurt anybody at all, I'm afraid. And he's like
Krill's in the background rubbing the bite mark on his shoulder.
So
I can't hurt anyone important.
That's fine.
Yeah. So he sits there and he kind of like thinks about it for a minute, and he doesn't seem too keen on the idea, but finally he says, I will talk to them. I will talk to the farmers and let them know what the situation is. But let the goofus birds know that if they step onto the farmer's land, then I will be back.
Well, that might just have to be good enough for now, but personally, I'm going to be watching you.
Well, it's easy to watch me. I'm very big, after all.
Yes, it helps.
So I guess unless you guys want to add anything to it, that's it.
Yeah, I think
successfully negotiated a peace treaty between the farmers and the goofus birds.
Hooray!
Astounding, we did it.
I got through my first D&D session. Oh my god. Wow.
That's really good.
Fantastic job,
did it.
Oh,
that
man.
Was great.
It could have been better, but I really appreciate you guys coming along.
It was great.
Gently, this was an fantastic. Astounding first session. You did good, really.
Thank you. All right. Well, without further ado, I guess we can just say goodbye to everybody. So, goodbye.
Bye.
Goodbye, everyone.